Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in Session 6. Before I begin, can I remind all members, if they're using electronic devices, to turn them to silent. Our first item of business this morning is an evidence session looking at the role of funding and finance and the climate and nature emergencies, particularly in relation to the rural economy. And I'm delighted to welcome our first witness, Sir Dieter Helm, Professor of Economic Policy at Oxford University. And we very much appreciate you finding time in your busy schedule to join us this morning. And we'll have until 10:30 for this session. Good morning, Professor Helm. I'm going to kick off with the first question. We've heard your views on natural capital before, but can you lay out exactly what is meant by natural capital and public goods, and how natural assets can be properly accounted for and embedded into our economies?
Well, the natural capital, in this case of Scotland, is the assets which nature bequeaths us for free and will go on bequeathing us for free for not just the next generation, but for all generations to come. And that distinguishes it from, you know, normal industry capital and also from human capital. And these assets, as I say, are in perpetuity. And so they have a special value, an open-ended value, which extends into the distant or far distant future. And the objective in environmental terms is to ensure that this set of assets are maintained so that this generation and future generations have the same opportunity to exploit them. Now, some of those assets are non-renewable, oil and gas. The North Sea is a classic example. And if one generation uses it, some compensation is needed for future generations so they benefit from that natural bequeathment forever. But the really important ones are the renewable natural capitals, and Scotland has abundant such assets. Public goods is an issue within this frame. A public good is not something that's just in the public interest, but a good which has a particular set of characteristics. It's non-excludable. If you benefit from it, so do I, or so can I. And and I can't stop you enjoying it, and you can't stop me enjoying it. And that's the excludability bit and the rivalness bit. And that's distinguished between normal market goods, which are excludable. If I go to the supermarket and buy something and eat it, you can't. And they are always excludable. The supermarket can sell it to me and not to someone else. And those are simple distinctions, but they make a great deal of difference in thinking about what governments should do and what it is that private markets could do if they were appropriately regulated and organised.
Thank you. Can I add something that has been very clear over the last few weeks as the damage that's been done by the storms, and we've had thousands of hectares of trees flattened. And some argue that these trees have been planted in the wrong place. They've been planted on good farmland or whatever. So how do you suggest we should properly account for natural capital when potentially at the moment we're seeing a bit of a land grab where big commercial companies to do a bit of greenwashing are buying land, some which is of very high value in terms of agricultural production and planting trees? Do we need to rapidly have a baseline and re-look at how we classify land to ensure that some of our best agricultural land is not turned into forestry? Is that part of what we need to do to assess our natural capital?
Well, if I were Scottish, I would be worrying very greatly about what's going on in the land market in Scotland at the moment. And I'd be worrying very much about the narrow silo approach to Scotland's natural environment, which comes from an exclusive focus on carbon. Of course, I'm deeply concerned about carbon, and carbon matters a great deal, and the opportunities to sequestrate carbon in Scotland are potentially enormous. But almost every sequestration, planting trees, for example, has impacts on other natural capitals at the same time. And land has competing uses. And if we put all the eggs in the carbon basket and ignore the other natural capitals, we'll end up planting the wrong trees in the wrong places and do natural capital as a whole potentially a lot of damage. There are competing uses between food production and biocrops and tree planting, etc. There always have been. And the way to sort these things out is to make sure that these markets all work on a level playing field. And I have to say, if you look at the land use in the UK as a whole, Scotland too, we have an enormously distorted agricultural sector, what I call the crazy economics of farming, which does not lead to farmers doing the right things in the right place. It leads to them doing the things which they're incentivized under the cap and the post-cap to do. And that also is part and parcel of this mix. So it's a hard ask, but we have to get the carbon bit right and the agricultural bit right and the biodiversity bit right and the water bit right. And I understand when people say, well, that sounds all very complicated. Yes, but if you don't take into account all the natural capitals at the same time in making decisions, could end up with some disastrous results. Recall that once it was thought that Scotland was a very good place to plant very large numbers of coniferous forests for timber. And there was a deep and significant market in timber, and timber was needed. But if you focus just on timber and nothing else, as has been done for quite a lot of the 20th century, you end up with some of the extremely inappropriate types of trees planted in some of the wrong places with quite a lot of environmental damage. So there is no way around the fact that you have to look at each and all of the dimensions of land use and not just look in one silo. Otherwise, you'll end up with a land grab. And I'm not close to develops in Scotland, but the tendency for financial institutions to simply buy big blocks of land to sell on as offsets. I mean, some of these offsets might be quite sensible, but that seems to me to be a very dangerous possibility. And what may well happen is it'll be a fait accompli. So it'll be done before anyone thinks about the consequences, and then you'll be stuck with the land ownership that then results and have to be thinking about retrospective regulation. So I would urge you to intervene now to think about what land ownership and land use should be in this carbon world before, as I say, it's a fait accompli.
Yeah, that's interesting. Because my next point was, has the horse bolted? Because we've already got targets set for tree planting, we've got targets set for peatland, and we're racing down that road. We've already looked at some of our routes to reaching net zero by 2045 based on trees, and generally that's going to be Sitka spruce. So do you think it's still possible to put the brakes on and do the work that you're talking about to ensure that we do get the right outcomes and we don't have Sitka spruce planted on agricultural land that would be better put to other use? What methods should we employ, or how can we get government to slow down a bit and look at the long-term implications rather than grab the low-hanging fruit?
Well, I don't have the privilege of being a politician and being elected to make these kinds of decisions. But all I can say from the outside is, you know, it is pretty crude to say you want to plant a number of trees by a certain date without any regard to where, what sort of trees, and some of the ancillary components of that. Now, that doesn't mean that it isn't a good case for planting a lot of trees. But again, the right trees in the right place. So what I would urge would be that you start with a baseline of what you've got and you shine the torch on how the proposals for people to do things change the ecosystems of Scotland, and the natural capitals of Scotland, though at least what's going on can be seen. Now, of course, there's an element of experiment in this, but from the outside, the idea that all the emphasis, or most of the emphasis should be on planting these spruces, assuming, of course, the new disease doesn't wipe them out. There's another issue about robustness in woodland planting when you choose a single species approach. But to look at that and see how that matches up against other alternative and, dare I say, cheaper ways of sequestrating carbon. Because when you look at the economics of a carbon offset from growing trees and think about the time horizon involved, it's not obvious that this is the most straightforward way. And you in Scotland have, on a global scale, peat of phenomenal interest and value in the carbon world and the biodiversity world. And my guess is that the carbon gains and the biodiversity gains and the water gains from addressing the peat as the priority would be greater than simply assuaging companies who can't or won't reduce their emissions by giving them an offset by planting another spruce plantation. But these calculations require, these considerations require a sound and careful shining of the torch on what's going on and hypothesizing, dare I say, different possibilities for Scotland's future landscape and land use. And if it's just allowed to happen, and then we'll see what happens, and then once it's happened, we'll work out whether it was a good idea. Well, have a look at your timber and your spruce plantations at the moment, and have a look at what Fraser Darling called the brown wet desert of lots of Scotland, and you'll realise that waiting and seeing and finding out what might be the consequence is not a very sound environmental policy.
Thank you for that. I've got a brief supplementary from Marianne before we move on to questions from Alistair Allen.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I'm just going to go a little bit in on the tree piece, because I'm really curious. I really like what you're saying about stand back and take a look at, you know, what's really the priority. But I'm also on a committee that has housing in the name, and I'm really curious about creating a future Scotland where we could actually build our housing from the timber that's grown here. And I know at the moment that's not possible because we can't, the tree quality is not good enough, and we have to do things like cross-laminated timber. But so I just want to see what you think about that, that, you know, can we be thinking about planting trees for those future generations, just like they've done in, you know, Salisbury Cathedral when it was built, they planted the trees for the beams of that cathedral to be replaced hundreds of years later. Can we be thinking along those lines with trees?
So I think there are at least two dimensions from the housing consideration. The first is that if you are planting trees, it's a good idea, particularly if they are, quote, the right kind of trees, to plant them right next to people, not next to power lines. And you want power companies to actually trim the trees to make sure that they don't actually fall on the wires, so people can then have some resilience against storms, etc. But the point about natural capital is natural capital is for us. Now, I often say nature doesn't care. We care about nature. And if you want the mental and physical health benefits and the air quality benefits that come from trees to accrue with the maximum advantage, put them next to people. Green cities, green belts around them. If you put trees in remote places, there'll be probably no physical and mental benefits because nobody will go there. And so there's an issue, a really profound issue, which has come up, I think, in clarity during the lockdowns, that trees have a function in the built environment, which is very important. Now, the second point you make is about what happens to the trees at end of life and how can they substitute for amazingly carbon-intensive stuff like steel and concrete. And for all the talk about greening steel and greening concrete, you know, spend a couple of minutes looking at the economics of what that would cost. And then think of the amount of embedded carbon that's going into the building construction right through the United Kingdom. These are really big ticket numbers. Okay. So if you think about this world of buildings, thinking of low carbon alternatives to steel and concrete is incredibly important. This comes back to what happens to the trees at the end of life. You know, there are lots of people go around and think we grow some trees, we have some biocrops, and then we'll burn them at the end and it's carbon neutral. Well, it's not carbon neutral. And burning at the end is putting carbon back, whereas the whole into the atmosphere, whereas the whole point of sequestration is to bury it, just like the oil and gas and coal was buried from hundreds of millions of years ago. So using timber in buildings is a really attractive option. It seals up that carbon. The alternative is to let the trees rot on the ground and let the nature take some of the carbon back into the soils. Of course, you'll lose quite a lot in the process, but you get a huge amount of biodiversity benefits by dead timber lying around. But just be careful in this territory, because if you plant a tree today, we're talking about locking it up into timber in a quarter of a century's time or more. And particularly if you're planting some of the more biodiversity rich trees, even further out. Those oak trees you were referring to in the example and Salisbury Cathedral were going to take 100 years or more to reach an outcome. Now, any private discount rate of 3, 4, 5%, the value today of something in 100 years' time in conventional accounting and business terms is approximately zero. Right? Whereas you want the house built tomorrow morning, and if you want the house built tomorrow morning, cement and steel are available. So yes, this is a route. Yes, this is a long-term sustainable option. Yes, anyone planting timber and buying offsets should explain what's going to happen at the end of life to the trees. But the scale of the opportunity is somewhat limited. But on the other hand, if it's imported timber, it's still locking up carbon. It's just not in your territorial account. So from a global warming point of view, great to use imported timber if you don't have any domestically. And also think about the kinds of buildings. But lots of people are putting up additional buildings in their gardens, etc., to benefit from work from home, all sorts of other alternatives. Putting up timber frame buildings in those contexts is really a quick win, as opposed to the longer term win, which is big construction factories and so on from timber, which is of course perfectly doable, but it's further out in the horizon. So yes, we should look very hard at the building sector and its use of timber. And yes, we should look extremely hard at what people propose to do with the trees they're selling offsets for at the end of life.
Thank you. We'll now move on to Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you, Sir Dieter. I have a lot of sympathy with what you're saying about Sitka spruce and monocultures, but I wonder if you could offer any views on where or how government should juggle these competing imperatives about, for all the right reasons, wanting to plant more trees, but the dangers of only planting trees that can deliver in the short term. How would you advise juggling those two competing things?
Well, I mentioned Sitka spruce, and they have their particular role. But of course, if you really want to sequestrate carbon quickly, you might as well plant a lot of Scotland with eucalyptus trees. They grow really quickly and they sequestrate carbon really fast, I'm told. My point's very simple. Nobody in their right minds thinks that you should have an open-ended position, plant anything you like, as long as the numbers add up to the total in the government's target for tree planting, and irrespective of location. In Scotland, you have a long experience of the debates about the flow country. Think what a carbon disaster it would have been to allow that lot to be covered in fast-growing timber. Think the damage to the peat. And what all this tells you is you have to have a land use plan. You can't simply leave private landowners to decide where they're going to plant these big plantations. You have to think, don't plant them on peat is a very simple and straightforward mantra. Actually, there might be some circumstances where you might, but allowing landowners to decide to plant trees on peat is not exactly consistent with addressing the urgency of the climate change problem and the carbon problem. In fact, it will make emissions worse. And you would know this in Scotland if you not only moved away from a territorial carbon production basis for measuring your carbon emissions, but if you actually measured really very carefully what the emissions from that peat and that, those soils and that land actually are in Scotland. It's easy enough to measure the carbon coming out of a power station. It's a lot harder to measure the carbon coming out of a field when someone ploughs it up. And it's a lot harder to measure the exact carbon emissions from a peat bog. But you should use, I think, a precautionary principle about peat in particular, but soils more generally too. And you should apply that. I say you should, you're the politician, I'm only someone from outside giving advice, but you should think really hard about having urgently the land use planning within which tree planting is set.
Kavir, you mentioned there, Sadita, also land ownership, and you'll be aware that land ownership has been a continuing matter of debate in Scotland for the last couple of centuries, or the pattern of land ownership, I should say. So there are examples now in some parts of Scotland of I should say, very well-intentioned and benign individuals coming in and buying very, very large amounts of land with their own ideas sometimes about what is good for the environment. Do you think that pattern of land ownership is entirely helpful to trying to achieve the kind of outcomes that you're talking about? And where do communities fit in to that debate when sometimes they have little say over what a landowner might do?
I'm very sensitive to how important land ownership is in Scotland as a deep political, social and economic issue. And there are two ways of thinking about this in this environmental context. The first is to say, well, you know, anyone can own anything, and we don't mind if a small number of individuals own most of Scotland. But we say, you might own it, but you don't control it. In other words, you can't do what you like on your land. We have rules and regulations and land use planning, which dictates what can be done here and what can be done there. And that's, you know, what we do in planning normally. You can't just build a house where you choose. You have to get planning permission. And that's widely accepted. People may get aggrieved about particular planning decisions, but I don't think anybody seriously thinks that we should allow a free-for-all for people to build wherever they like. But we seem to think you can have a free-for-all to do what you like to the natural capital assets, which are not just bequeathed to the current citizens of Scotland, but to all future generations of citizens. So my starting point is, if you're not prepared, or you don't think, or there are arguments against interfering on who can own what, you should at least separate the control of what they do with the land from the ownership of the land. And I'm aware of huge controversies in Scotland, but also in England, about what you can do. Whether you can hunt on your own land is, at least in England, a legal matter, and so on. And remember, too, that we shape the incentives of landowners by the crazy economics of the subsidies of agriculture. And that, I think, is something which any government should be looking at extremely carefully about its environmental consequences. But I would go slightly further. You know, I don't know any country in the world that doesn't have concern about foreign ownership of very, very large tracts of land. It's been an issue in England since the Norman Conquest about who can own what and where. And when people propose very large scale change of land use over very large areas, it would be amazing if there weren't social, cultural and environmental consequences which go beyond the interests of the particular landowner. And I'm sure they understand that. And the fashion in Scotland for massive, large-scale rewilding projects fits into this frame. And you have to be very careful about rewilding. Rewilding is a conservation technique. There is no such thing as the wild, and there is no such thing as a universal idea that if you just abandon the land, somehow that will be best for nature. I'm afraid there isn't any part of this planet which man has not interfered with. Scotland is a very managed landscape, contrary to, I think, how quite a lot of people see it. And that brown, wet desert of Scotland was created by deliberate acts of choice about how farming, sheep farming and so on, and clearances and so on, would operate. The deer population is a choice. Okay? And rewilding projects, which may in particular circumstances be the best conservation strategy, nevertheless require huge amounts of intervention. Rewilding does not involve going around shooting deer. Good conservation does in certain circumstances, and I think we should be very careful about sorting out what is in the private interest of people who own very large amounts of land and what's in the public interest. Whether you choose to do that by land reform in the deep sense that Scotland has in the past tried to address this issue, or whether you do it by asserting what the public interest is, and therefore by having an element of control over how land is used, that's historically how it's been done. And what I'm urging, and particularly in regard to the discussion about planting forest versus peatland, just as an example, is that that isn't something that can be left purely to private owners to decide what happens.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to the theme of public funding and ask Ariane for her question.
Thank you, Convener. I've got a couple of questions. And I really appreciate your responses earlier. I'd appreciate hearing from you about the role that public funding can play in addressing the climate and nature emergencies, including whether it's more effective when it stipulates what must be done or when it stipulates what outcomes must be achieved.
Okay, let me address the first part of that question, and then we might come to outputs, etc. So, if you want to work out how to achieve a net zero target in Scotland by a particular date, and if you want to achieve certain targets in respect to biodiversity, etc., the first thing to do is to stop doing perverse things. Okay. So what the first step is, before you get any public money coming into the frame, look at the private incentives to establish the baseline to which public money and public funds should be an addition to get stuff done. And that's particularly in the public goods dimension. So if you look at the carbon position in Scotland, first of all, it's a territorial carbon production target. So if you achieve it, you will not stop causing climate change. And I tried to point that out when I was involved in the advisory work on the recovery in Scotland. You know, you can close down Grangemouth, you can close down all the rest of any of energy intensive activities in Scotland, import the stuff instead, and your carbon territorial production will go down. And I think that most people, certainly in England, would say that what they want to do in achieving net zero is to ensure that they no longer cause climate change. You can only do that on a carbon production basis. And if you distort the market so that there's a pressure on decarbonisation in Scotland, but not on importers, what you're doing is giving a pollution subsidy to people who export to Scotland. And this is nonsense, and it's not going to help against climate change. But, you know, if you really want to get towards your target as fast as possible, go round and close down those businesses. Close down Grangemouth and import all those petrochemicals instead. That'll make quite a big dent, and do it really quickly. And it'll be terrible for climate change. Not to say that you wouldn't want to do things about emissions from Grangemouth, but that's a separate issue. So first of all, sort out what it is you're actually trying to achieve. And Scotland has an opportunity here, even within the overarching framework, of at least publishing really clear carbon consumption accounts so that the people can see where these substitutions are being made. Now, when we move on from that, if you look across Scotland at the sectors that can contribute to for the reduction of carbon. Think agriculture, think heating, think transport, oh, and think electricity and energy production too. So within that space, agriculture is a really big ticket story in the total territorial emissions properly measured in Scotland, and of course on carbon consumption. Okay? Agriculture covers much of the land of Scotland, and of course, as I've said, a lot of it remains, as Fraser Darling described it, as a wet brown desert. The peat is particularly important, but there are lots of other dimensions, the management of the soils and so on and so forth. So you want to sort those things out. The theoretical right answer is to have appropriate price of carbon and apply it to all the sectors. I understand why people don't want to do that, but subsidising agriculture to pollute while taxing the energy sector to reduce emissions is a fairly crazy policy, but it's almost ubiquitous across most of Europe and indeed especially in the United States. So you need to sort out this baseline. Now, once you've done that, you have to work out what the missing bits are that you would do on top, rather than trying to compensate for the damage that the wrong policies are doing to encourage people to have more emissions than they need to have for an efficient Scottish economy. And here is the public goods. And in my mind, the core to those are what I regard as the infrastructures. And they are the physical infrastructures, transport system, the energy transmission distribution systems, the water systems, and especially the fibre networks. Those have very important public system characteristics, and it's very important that policy shapes those being put in place. You can make the taxpayer pay, or you can make the customer pay, but these are systems for everybody, not marginal, additional, discrete added bits. And then there's the natural infrastructure, the natural systems, the natural capital assets, which we've been talking about so far. And those are primary targets for thinking about public funding, especially biodiversity, because biodiversity is very, very hard to turn into anything other than public. And there are additional problems about how to measure it, what it means, what its component parts are. But a policy that protects and enhances biodiversity is usually a policy that protects and enhances natural systems. But even in things like peat, there's no reason why a carbon price would not be an appropriate way of adding some funds to the frame within which this stuff can be addressed.
Thank you. Ariane, any?
No, thank you for that. Very comprehensive. I have to say I'm very glad that this is being recorded, because I'm going to watch that bit again to absorb it all. I was intrigued by your proposal that public budgets could be set for river catchment areas and interested parties could bid for a portion of the budget to provide environmental outcomes. And I'd be interested to hear if you have other ideas for innovative approaches to distributing funding and how you believe these would result in achieving greater environmental outcomes.
Okay, so let's take the river catchments. Okay, so some people regard as hopeless pragmatist in these things. I want to be roughly right rather than where you are at the moment, which is pretty much precisely wrong. Okay, so I want to think about how public money might be used, and I want to think about the frame within which that's set, and I want to think about that in terms of the natural infrastructures of the economy, the ecosystem. And certainly south of the border, and please always bear in mind that my experience is more south of the border than north, one way of carving up a landmass like the United Kingdom is by river catchments. And the reason for that is to do with geology and geography. And you have some phenomenal river catchments in Scotland, thinking about the Tay, the Spey, etc. Now, river catchments involve water abstraction. We need water as part and parcel of our basic needs. They involve floods and flood defense. They involve a great deal of integrated nature. They are corridors. And there are multiple parties at play. So if you take any catchment, there's forestry and forestry interests, there are water companies, there are flood defence organisations, there are nature organisations interested in the biodiversity, there are tourist organisations, there are whiskey distillery organisations using the water. And what really worried me south of the border is we designed a system for our river catchments in which the water companies are responsible for water and sewage, but nothing else. We have flood defence through the Environment Agency responsible for flood defence, but not the provision of water. We have farmers completely independent of those activities and responsible for a great deal south of the border, the pollution going to those rivers. And then we have all sorts of local authorities and others interested in access and the use of nature and so on. So I had in mind that you would take the system and have a system regulation or system operator for it in the same way we have for the national grid. That's a system, and we have a system operator function for that. And by the way, you should have them for your regional electricity companies as well. That would lead to a lot better planning than the situation that, at least in the southeast of Scotland, you've experienced. And then they would have a budget. And that budget would include the public monies being spent already in the catchment. Turns out most of those are agriculture, actually, but then you could make much bigger gains by reallocating the agricultural budgets and virtually anything else you could do in most catchments, certainly south of the border. It would include the flood defence money, and it would include thinking about the components of the water bills that water customers are paying, especially where they're not metered. And what you do is you say, we want a catchment plan. We want a view about what's going to happen to the Spey. We want a view about what's going to happen to the Thames. The catchment regulator, the catchment operator, the catchment planner doesn't start with, I know the answer and I will impose it style and like upon you. They say, right, we go through a process and ask people to imagine different possibilities for the catchment. Then you do a baseline natural capital survey, digital data, et cetera, to know exactly what the baseline is. You look at the ways the money could be spent and you see which enhancements have the greatest net benefits to all the natural capitals taken into account simultaneously. Then you ask the private sector to bid to do those things. So farmers can come forward and say, you know what, I could plant trees along the riverbank and that would have the following benefit. It would cost me the following, my bid is for that money. Water companies would bid in, and they might negatively bid in as they do in some areas in the south of England, to pay farmers to keep cover crops in place to stop the silt and the pollution going into the rivers. And the flood defence people might say, you know, we're not building any more concrete, we'll pay people to do certain things about land management further down the river. But the central point here is you have to see it as an integrated system, not as a series of discrete bits, which is how we currently do water, agriculture and flood defence at the moment. My guess is that we could do, and I'm always sceptical about this phrase, but I think it's appropriate, a lot more for quite a lot less. And it seems to me that since the environmental challenges we face, climate change, yes, biodiversity, etc., are not going to be cheap, as some environmentalists imagine, I think they're going to be really quite expensive. And customers, voters, individuals, consumers, citizens, are in the end, all going to pay one way or another. It beholds us to use the public monies we have at the moment in a more efficient way. Now, it's then a question of how much extra money should you allocate to these catchments to do the public goods bits? Okay. And I think it's a sensible way to go about this to say, well, I want to know if this money was spent on the Spey and not on the Tay, what will be the difference? What's the project? What is the environmental benefits that are going to come from these things? And you could even imagine catchments saying, you know what, you should give us more money and them less. And then we'd have some contesting and some challenge, and we'd really see what the benefits are. All in the context, which is relatively new, that you can create digital baselines in considerable resolution detail of exactly what's currently going on, And therefore, you have the opportunity not just to say, you know, I like this, you like that, oh, I think this is better and that's worse. You say, I'm going to map exactly what it would look like in that catchment if we put that forest in this particular place. That's a huge advantage, which was not available 5 years ago and is improving very fast and into the future. Digital mapping as part of land use planning and public money spending will be absolutely mainstream and normal.
Thank you very much. I'll now move to questions from Rachel and Jenny.
Sadita Helm might be interested that actually the Tweed Forum are doing a consultation on the catchment, the Tweed catchment management. So that's something that we should possibly look at in this committee. I apologise for going back to some of the questions that have possibly already been asked, but I'm very interested in market-based mechanisms and the intervention of Scottish Government with £50 million fund from the Scottish National Investment Bank, which is incentivising natural assets. I want to really get your opinion on what risks might be associated with carbon trading and whether you believe that, I think you've said this already, that we should put our natural assets at the forefront as the priority rather than the other way around.
I was going to say, of course, I don't like the words of course, but of course you should put the natural assets at the front. You know, as I say, I only advise you are privileged to make decisions, but I humbly put it to you, it's your duty to make sure that the future generations inherit a decent Scotland and to live their lives as they choose. So, of course, if you don't look to the natural assets, you are, in effect, vulnerable to the possibility you're trashing the future opportunities to future citizens. So, of course, you're going to do that. Now, the market-based mechanisms, there's a lot of hype talked about market mechanisms, and there's a lot of criticisms which are not valid too. No market exists in a kind of laissez-faire wonderland. All markets are regulated. Capitalism developed because the state powerfully could guarantee property rights. And if you look at any market, and particularly the ones that people think are most capitalist, like, you know, stock exchanges and share trading and so on, these are highly regulated. Right? They set the rules. Who trades, where they trade, what they trade, what information they use, that's probably more regulated than virtually anything else. But when I ask my students what they think the most capitalist market is, they usually come up with those financial markets. So it's a nonsense to say it's either the state or the market. And it would be, to me, a big stretch to imagine that the state taking over many of these functions that are currently market functions would be right now a great idea to hasten us towards net zero and protecting the biodiversity. So the question is how to regulate markets appropriately and focus on what they can do well and not try to get them things to do things which are inherently not amenable to market. So in the carbon world, where most people have thought about this, on the emissions side, market mechanisms which are based upon setting a carbon price are inherently sensible. The reason for that is a ton of carbon emitted anywhere is homogeneous. It's the same as any ton of carbon emitted anywhere else. That's why earlier I emphasized carbon consumption, not carbon production. Doesn't matter whether the steel was made in China or as it used to be in Scotland. It's just carbon emissions. And so if you want to address global warming, you would ideally have a carbon price, which would lead the market to sort out the cheapest ways of reducing emissions. Actually, if you thought about it, peat would be a pretty good target for this, but power stations and so on fall in that frame. The problems come with the sequestration side for market mechanisms and so-called carbon offsets. I understand that you can now quote buy a net zero LNG tanker cargo sailing towards Milford Haven on the grounds that the relevant oil or gas company has planted a lot of trees in the United States. This is not what we mean by appropriate offsetting markets. This is an example of where, instead of doing sequestration and carbon emissions reductions, we think that it's perfectly substitutable to do one or the other. The second thing to say about offsets is no two offsets on the ground are alike. Not like emissions, where the emissions are the same wherever they happen. If you plant the trees on a bit of the flow country in Scotland, that is not the same thing as planting the trees on the banks of the River Tweed. And so there isn't the possibility of a clean, open, transparent, liquid, deep offsets market, which is quite contrary to what Carney and others have been advocating. That could lead to some really difficult outcomes. Doesn't mean that people shouldn't pay for the carbon offsets, and that would be an extraordinarily, or potentially an extraordinary revenue stream for our natural environment, perhaps the biggest one on offer out there. But what we can't have is simply people then trading them on as if they're like trading carbon emissions in a straightforward market way. And I suspect that many landowners would be really rather worried if they did a deal with an ESG compliant company to help them with offsets and suddenly found that the offset was sold by a financial institution to ExxonMobil or Saudi Aramco or someone else. And so one needs to think quite carefully about who are the trustees and guardians of these offsets and how exactly are the property rights around them constrained by regulation. It's a detailed area, and as a side, I thought a lot about how to do this, including setting up trust funds, investment trusts, to put trustees in place over these areas while getting the revenues in as well. And remember too, in the offset market, just because you do a deal with someone to plant a tree, that doesn't mean that you've sequestrated that carbon today. You need to know that it's going to be sequestrated maybe in 25 years' time. You need to make sure the capital maintenance is done. You need to keep the deer and the grey squirrels out. And you need to know what happens at the end of that life of that project. Again, that's completely different from buying a ton of carbon emissions in respect of, what was Longannet or something like that going forward. So I'm afraid market design is of the essence of how we regulate in order to ensure that the best profit-seeking private incentives deliver the public outcomes that we're interested in, and not just, but they must as well, deliver the private benefits. I'm sorry, it's a bit of a convoluted answer, but this is not a this is not amenable to the kind of simple propositions which were floated at places like Glasgow. It needs to be thought through. Otherwise, there could be some really quite nasty unintended consequences.
Sadita, I was tickled by a comment that made the Scotsman, which, and you said it wasn't enough for big corporations to greenwash themselves by purchasing carbon offset credits in the same manner as nobility had purchased redemption from the church in medieval times. And I think that basically summarises what you've just said. My next question is really just about to get that public-private balance and the equality of benefit for everybody. You talked about, you know, the Central Belt, not just planting trees in swathes of highland, land in trees, but using Central Belts as, part of that conversation, I suppose. This isn't about that specifically, but how do we, with regulation, separate emission reduction and carbon sequestration and judge the success of both of those either separately or together?
Okay, so the first thing to say is that we need both. And that was my point about the church indulgences. Okay, you know, I perfectly understand, and I think there's a lot of a substance in environmentalists who look at horror offsetting and saying, you know, look, we don't want it is an excuse to carry on emissions given the timetable for the net zero targets, we have to have, you know, brakes on the accelerators of both emissions reductions and sequestration. Okay, that's the first thing to say. The second thing to say is, by having a brick on the sequestration side, if we do the land management properly, the benefits are vastly beyond the benefits of the carbon reduction. And if you think about just soil, and you think about carbon in soil, and think about what modern agriculture has done to our soils, okay? You know, I'm not a scientist, I'm an economist, but my understanding is there are two kind of quite interesting stylized facts about soils. The first is the soil has about 3 to 4 times the carbon of the atmosphere. You have to let that sink in. That's our primary carbon sink on this planet. Okay? And of course, Scottish soils are thin in particular places. But, you know, if you're a North Uist and you're looking at the peat, the carbon density is very, very high. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that the carbon in the soils is quite a good proxy for the biodiversity in the soils. And that links to a third observation, which is most biodiversity is beneath your feet. Right? We all think about biodiversity as letting beavers back or having lynxes running around, and I'm not against either of those in the right circumstances. But these are trophy bits of biodiversity. They might be important for controlling the deer, though I'm sure a rifle will be more effective. This is the stuff on the top. It's what's in the soil that's the basis of our system, our invertebrate life, and what's constructed above it. So multiple benefits come up on the sequestration side. So we need to focus quite hard upon those. Now, is it wrong to allow private sector companies to buy offsets? No. And is it wrong to, or would it be a good idea to turn down that particular revenue stream? And I think it would be a big mistake now to not have that private financial inflow coming in. What I'm concerned about is how it comes in and what constitutes a proper offset and how that's managed going forward. So that's why I like the idea that when people want to sell offsets, they sell into a trust fund. And many people could invest in these trust funds. So I'm a company, and supposing I'm a reputable company, whatever that means. But let's say, for example, I'm ESG compliant, et cetera, and I'm doing all the right things. But I have some emissions which, you know, stand up to inspection, that they really are incredibly hard for me to deal with. And I convince all and everyone, including this trust fund, that I have got a good reason for investing in an offset. When I buy into that fund to get that offset, I might undertake never to sell my offset until I have delivered my net zero target, and only to sell it on to someone else who's also ESG compliant and has a proper net zero strategy and proper accounting. So I think that there's a lot to be said for some companies and some local authorities and some public organizations being involved in, quote, trading carbon offsets, but trading only to those who are acceptable and compliant companies, and not allowing them simply to sell it on to ExxonMobil or whoever elsewhere. No criticism of ExxonMobil intended in my comment, but just to make that point. And it comes back to the earlier statement about market mechanisms. Regulation is of the essence. If you want a wild west of carbon offsets, then don't expect Scotland's natural environment to be in a particularly good state going forward. Expect a land grab, and expect the plantation of the fastest growing trees that sequestrate carbon at the fastest possible rate, and don't worry about who ends up owning these things. I think we could do much better than that without ruling out bringing offsetting into the frame.
Thank you.
Okay, and we've got a question from Jenny.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Sir Dieter Helm. So this is very, very helpful, very informative. I'd like to ask a few more questions on the market mechanism. You've you've talked about the importance of regulation and intervention now before it becomes a fait accompli. I was at a COP26 fringe event where it was suggested that perhaps the market may be moving more quickly than the regulation, legislation or government is. So I'm interested to know what the risks and opportunities are for agriculture, fisheries, tenant farmers as well as land farmers with regards to the market-based mechanisms and private funding and how that helps us achieve the just transition.
There's a lot packed into your question, so I'll do my best. So farmers are best treated as businesses. They are profit maximising. They're trying to get the maximum yield from their land. They, of course, care about the land going forward, but they have a discount rate like any other business does as well. And farmers, in my experience, probably respond to incentives almost better than any other sector I know of. Farmers are extremely good at working out what they're going to be paid for, how to get paid, and changing their behavior accordingly. If someone comes along and wants to pay them very large sums of money to produce biogases, you can have 1,000-acre Tayside farms completely turned into growing ryegrass and other materials for biogases. And this is the issue, okay, or one of the issues. You have to be very careful when you create an incentive to do X because you've got a target within a particular frame, say biofuels, without thinking through what the other consequences are, and those other consequences flow from what other incentives farmers have. And farmers are private businesses. They're not in the public good business per se, unless someone offers to pay them to deliver public goods. So if they look at their land going forward and they plan into the future, they've got to take into account not just the fact that they may be paid to manage the carbon, not just that they may be regulated over what they do, which impacts upon the carbon, but they have to look at what the future of food production itself looks like. So I'm much taken by the scale of the technological revolution taking place in farming. I'm not quite at the level of thinking that it's all indoor farming, but if you go and look at the indoor vertical farming little pilot at the Hutton Institute in Dundee, you'll see some of the ways these things are going. And basically, farming is going to be in the frame of a massive digitalization revolution, which enables any farmer to know what's happening down to, you know, almost a square meter on the land in fantastic detail. That's a complete revolution from the old model that a particular farmer who farmed an area for their life, that she would know through almost instinct, but feel and knowledge of what exactly was in each field corner. Now you can see it from a satellite. This is transformational. The second thing that's true is that robotics are changing greatly the way in which crops are managed. You can see what's going to happen in the soft fruit industry in Scotland, down to, you know, enormous research going into how you design a robot to pick a raspberry. That seems to be quite an interesting problem. And then you've got the genetic revolution too. And the genetics isn't just about animals. There are all sorts of questions in all of these technologies, but it's very much also about plants and the plant sciences. It's perfectly plausible going forward that if you're a farmer, you might actually need less land to produce your output in the future than you currently do. I think the idea that you're going to need more land just because the demand for food goes up is one of those assumptions which has been true in the 20th century, but is no longer true going forward. Do you now confront lots of other opportunities? You can be a carbon farmer. You can be a wildlife farmer. You can look to hedgerows. Rather different in Scotland, a lot of Scotland, than they are in the south of England. You can look at being paid to do certain things which impact less on the environment, but you can look at the other side too and realise you're going to be much more heavily regulated and in my own view, hopefully taxed for the pollution that farming causes to the environment. And you have to put this in a frame. You know, agriculture for the United Kingdom produces about 10-11% of total emissions without properly measuring the soil and the peat emissions. That's for 0.5% of GDP. So agriculture is by far the largest relative polluter in carbon terms, whereas it should actually be a net sequestrator. So I would say the opportunities here to change farming practice to produce better outcomes are enormous and greater than any other sector of the economy. And farmers looking forward over the next 25 years are going to face very different prices and very different incentives. And they will, in the same way as they have done historically, respond to those changes of technology, respond to those prices, and think quite hard about how they're going to use their land going forward. It's the public duty to shape those incentives at least a little less inefficiently than they have been for the last 70 years. Hard to think of a less appropriate set of incentives than the ones we've confronted farmers with since the Second World War.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I have seen the vertical farming that's being worked on in Invergowrie. Can I shift slightly to specifically tenant farmers who aren't, if you could kind of respond in respect to them, who perhaps the situation is if they're tenancy agreement is cut and they can't get back in because of what the landowners are looking to do with their land.
So the tenancy issue, I mean, at one level, it's a sort of deep, particularly Scottish issue about ownership of land, landlordism and all those kinds of things. But let me focus on the practicalities. There are two here. First of all, if a tenant doesn't have security of tenure, then it's very unlikely that the sorts of things, particularly in the carbon sequestration bit, are going to make economic sense to those tenant farmers because the payback is usually beyond the length of the tenancy. Mm-hmm. So if you have security of tenure, and you think about how security worked with the Crofters Acts and all those kinds of things, that's absolutely crucial to the incentive structure. But the thing that really worries me is the idea that what we might do, and I have not really any knowledge of how this is working in Scotland, but I have observed it elsewhere. We might say, you know, I'm a really big investment financial institution. What I'm going to do is see that the value of this land is to buy it up and flog off the carbon offsets from it and financialize that product. Now, the problem is, if you want to take a big chunk of land, buy it, and plant it with trees, basically, you've got to clear off the tenants. And this is a hypothetical example, of course. Okay. And if I were a tenant farmer, seeing some of the direction of travel in the offset world and what some of the financial institutions are bringing to the table, I would worry that my future as a tenant was quite close to zero. And that leads to a public issue about whether you only want land managed by people who have full ownership and control rights, or whether you want the land partly tenanted, properly regulated land use terms, so that particular individuals or particular financial institutions who buy up large chunks of Scotland can't simply impose what may turn out to be a much more profitable route. Once landowners thought that sheep were more profitable than crofters. And I can't help see an analogy between the idea that trees might be very much more profitable than small tenant farmers. But that's the issue ultimately the Scottish government to sort out what the property rights structure is and whether or not crofters and tenants have sufficient security of tenure to ensure that they can participate in this future world and the changes that go with it. No reason why they should be any less good or bad than full ownership. That's to be sorted out. But again, as I said earlier, if you wait for the land grab to have happened, it's going to be incredibly late to try to bring tenants back who've gone.
Great. Thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Can I ask a supplementary? You mentioned maybe carbon farmers, a nature farmer, a food farmer, a cultural farmer, a soil farmer, or a tech farmer at the moment. And traditionally, farmers have been all of these things all together, all at the same time, and had to pay regard to them all. Some pay more regard to food production than nature, and some the other way around. In the future, do you see the broad spectrum of responsibilities still being spread as they are just now, with every farmers taking responsibility in different degrees over all these different aspects of land management? Or do you see regional land use partnerships and the likes actually specifying areas which should focus on food production or focus on protecting crested newts, for example, or whatever? How do you see it all coming together to deliver what we need, and that is a recovery in our biodiversity and ultimately climate change?
So farmers are the land managers. They are there on the ground. They make decisions given the incentives that surround them as to what they're going to do with that land. And there's no framework of kind of Stalinistic planning that can go around telling farmers, you do X here, Y there, you grow this crop here, you grow that crop there. We had a bit of that after the Second World War, but basically there are so many unintended consequences, so much balancing to be done, that someone has to exercise discretion. Okay? And that's what ownership does. But within the framework of the incentives that are put in place, and a broad take on the land use management. Okay? And that's why I think you can't get away from the idea that you have to take a broad view about land use in Scotland. That doesn't mean prescribing particular bits, but it should inform the incentive structure that's put in place. Now, what I'm against, or would be minded to be against, is the idea that you can designate some areas for intensive food production and some areas for nature. And this is a kind of protected area. We have some, you know, special bits over here, but, you know, you trash that bit there in the most intensive way you possibly can. This seems to me to be a kind of apartheid, which is, seems to me, scientifically nonsense. It seems to be nonsense from the point of view of the land more generally. You know, in the end, if you continue down some of the paths of really intensifying agricultural production, you'll trash the land. And again, this is this question of ensuring that these assets are available, not just for this generation, but for future generations. So I'm just as interested in what happens in a piece of intensive potato growing areas or a barley production towards the east side of Scotland, as I'm interested in what happens to Highland sheep management. And what one has to do is focus carefully on the incentives. If you put fertilizer onto the land, which we are going to do for a very long time to come, it will have some unintended consequences as it flows off into the rivers. Go down the Tweed and look at the algae in the summer. Right? So you need to incentivize people to use less of that, and you also need to help farmers to use the technology to understand in detail the quality of the land to work out how to target these things and to target pesticides and so on. So I really don't think there's an apartheid between food and nature. Food is produced by nature, and these things should be thought of in parallel. Now, that doesn't mean that, you know, every bit of land has to be used the same. Quite the contrary. It's not possible to grow a whole variety of crops on the West Coast, which it is possible to grow on the East. But in that process, one wants a set of incentives polluter pays principle, the provision of support through public goods to the R&D and some of the technical changes are out there, which create a different set, ultimately, of prices and returns for farmers, and then they can use the discretion that's available to choose what to do. I neither believe the idea that farmers are natural altruists who will always do the best thing for nature, nor do I believe that they're rapine capitalists who are going to do a lot of damage for the short term. They just respond like any other business, the incentives in front of them and the regulatory framework they're set and the subsidy regimes in place. And that's, put it bluntly, your job as politicians to sort out, and you'll get the results according to how well that framework's put in place.
Thank you. Jim's going to come in with a question. Just on the back of what you said, we've, for some time now, the principle of public goods for public money has been suggested the way forward south of the border. And we're now seeing some policies coming forward. Some don't view them as particularly a good move. In Scotland here, it's still quite unclear the direction of travel that future rural support's going to take, particularly with the replacement for CAP. Is there anything that you see from what has been introduced south of the border should be adopted up here, and what should we avoid when it comes to future rural payments?
So the first thing to say is that, as with all these revolutions, you have a set of bold ambitions as to what's to be done with agricultural policy. And actually, it doesn't end up back with the status quo ex ante, but it ends up much more evolutionary than the advocates of the revolution put in place in the first instance. What I mean by that is that when you look at particularly the SFI, the Sustainable Finance bit, which is the big chunk, it's not that different from Pillar 1 of the CAP. And if you look at the greening components, it's actually not that different from what the Europeans are proposing to do to the CAP. Okay, so this idea that the England is on a pedestal and it's completely different from what everyone else is doing, the reality is a lot more nuanced than that. That's my first thing to say. The second thing to say is that it is true that the big advance in England is to put the concept of public money for public goods on the face of the Act and make it the abiding principle of what's going forward. It's a bit like a slogan like Dig for Victory after the Second World War. It's the motivating driver. It forces people to try to say why we should give them taxpayers' and citizens' money to do things and what the benefit to us, the public, is going to be of that as opposed to their private interest. The worst possible way of running an agricultural subsidy system is to pay people to own land. What benefit is that to a citizen of Glasgow or Edinburgh or Stirling to know that somebody who buys X thousand acres of Scotland is going to be paid X thousand times a number per hectare because they own it? You know, it's just extraordinary. We know where we got there because previously we paid them to produce output and they did exactly what was said on the tin. They produced the output and we ended up with butter mountains and milk lakes and goodness knows what else. Wine lakes, they were much more interesting than milk lakes to me anyway. You know, this is a crazy way of doing things. And that's why land prices, one of the reasons why land prices are so high in Scotland. If you buy an asset and I pay you, you know, £10 a hectare, you'll capitalise that in the price because I've given you an annuity of £10 an acre going forward. Right? So, you know, and that excludes young farmers coming into the system. It excludes lots of parties who might want to buy their tenancy and so on and so forth. That's crazy. Okay. So we need to move away from that. Now, my worry in England is that what we're actually doing is not identifying the public goods. We're sort of saying, tell you what, look, we'll send a consultant round. They'll come up with a farm plan. And if we like the farm plan, we'll give you a subsidy. And you know what? The subsidy may just turn out to be something like what you were previously receiving under the Pillar 1 payment for owning land. That's crazy. But That's the essence of where it goes. And what we have to do now, and what the advantage we have in England over Scotland and Wales and Northern Ireland is, you're now forced to, in the what I call the public domain, explain why exactly money is being given to a farmer in terms of, so what exactly is the public good we get from this? And last week I heard on our farming, Radio 4 Farming Today program in the morning, the Secretary of State DEFRA say, well, I don't know why farmers are whinging it's not enough money. They're going to get paid for quite a lot of things they're going to do anyway. What is the point of using public money to pay people to do things they would do anyway? Could I have a public subsidy, please, because I'm going to walk to the station? I would have walked to the train station anyway. That's not what public money is for. And this is an example where, in the ordinary course of events, this is taxpayers' money, public funds, not getting the benefits they could. But if you've got a net zero target of the form you've got in Scotland, and you really have the biodiversity targets you have in mind, you don't have the luxury to waste money in ways that aren't going to build towards those targets. You know, I put it to you that every penny that's available, and I think it's going to be very expensive, so I think the consumers are going to have to pick up the tab for this, and the taxpayers, every penny is actually advancing you towards your target. It's not perverse, and it's not wasted. The advantage of having the terms public money for public goods, which I personally put a huge effort into pushing, is that at least it frames that discussion and enables citizens to ask questions of agriculture, which in the past they may not have done. And perhaps it would have been okay in the past, but not with the climate and the biodiversity targets we now have.
Thank you. And Jim would like to come in the back of that.
Yeah. Dieter, you are a fantastic witness. I have been engrossed with everything that you've been saying here. But as somebody who's been farming, if I was still farming, I'd be sitting outside going, oh my God, I hope he doesn't develop the policy or we are not going to be getting a penny. Now, I may be completely misrepresenting what you're saying there, but there's a couple of points I would like to raise with you. And the other thing that I've got out of this conversation is that what we can talk in silos, and it sounds great until you start to bring in what the unintended consequences are. You have given us so much to think about. I really have thoroughly enjoyed this session. But one of the things that I have in my head, and correct me if I'm wrong, food costs either through the public purse, through subsidy, either in land degradation and environmental damage, or the consumer pays for it through their purse when they go and buy it in the shops. Now, the subsidy system at the moment that was introduced after the Second World War, it used to be that a household income was about 30% in food. Now it's about 8.5%. So the public value in subsidy is, it could be argued, in the fact that food is cheap. However, there is the counter to that, that we can buy food from Australia or America or whatever. And if we can bring it in a lot cheaper, is the price out of the pocket to the consumer still going to be met by bringing in cheap food from elsewhere? And it's that whole dichotomy. Now, that's a huge question. It's a short statement, but it's a huge question. How do you square that?
Okay, so let me unpack these questions. And let me premise it by a remark. You know, it's sometimes said, you know, I'm an academic commenting on these things. Well, my family were all farmers or in horticulture. So I've grown up and I do have an understanding, some understanding of the practicalities that face people who actually have to do these things on the front line. And I hope that I am that hopeless pragmatist and not just trying to think through principles. So if I was a farmer looking forward, okay, I struggle to think that I would, as a farmer, believe that the system we've got and where we've got to is going to be sustained for much longer anywhere. You know, most farmers can see what has happened and they have responded to the incentives that are in front of them. You know, I'm working on an example in the south of England at the moment on Chichester Harbour. It's going to be biologically dead in 10 years' time, and half the pollution comes off the farmland. Nobody can imagine that's a sustainable position to go forward. Okay? It's different in different circumstances. So I look at my farm and I say, so should I just say, gosh, this is awful. I'm going to be asked to do all this stuff and my business model and my profits are going to collapse. Or should I say, this is a cornucopia of opportunities to do farming better and to increase the productivity and indeed the profits of what I do. So first of all, I look out the window and see the technology come. I mean, farming productivity has an appalling record over the last 10, 20, 30 years. And the opportunities the technologies it would bring to do my job better are great. And my personal view is that the technical change is going to dwarf all the rest of the stuff we've talked about from a farming business model perspective. Not every farm is going to have a maths graduate, preferably from Oxford rather than Cambridge, running the farm. But this is going to be a much more high-tech job in the bigger farming areas. I look at a huge market in carbon. I'm now going to have an opportunity to benefit from sequestration practices. Yes, I'm going to have to reduce my emissions. Yes, things like red diesel are indefensible subsidies to diesel in a world in which we're trying to decarbonize. Those can't be done, but there are all sorts of other technologies coming along, including actually hydrogen, in the farming sector. And then when we turn to what foods I grow, you know, if we had proper carbon border prices, if we had carbon consumption and not carbon production as the target, if we paid at the border, at the docks, for the destruction of that rainforest in the Amazon to grow beef to compete with Scottish beef, I would see that my market's going to get bigger, not smaller, because all that agricultural trade you talk about has potentially very, very big carbon components. And that would be extremely important. What I don't want to do is find myself faced with a whole variety of environmental costs lumped upon me and the guys in Brazil moving off from the expansion of soil to clear the rainforest for the cattle, just picking up my market. That's not acceptable. The sheep's different. Not true that sheep in New Zealand are, once they've actually been delivered in the UK, necessarily more carbon intensive than sheep produced in the uplands in parts of the UK. So different in different cases. But the carbon border adjustment, having proper carbon pricing, gives British farmers, Scottish farmers, a much better frame. And there were some discussions at Glasgow at carbon border adjustments. The EU, of course, is pushing ahead with this and should be on this side. And my final bit is about cheap food. It is a complete myth that the common agricultural policy produces cheap food. It does not. It has customs barriers all around it to keep the price of food up in the EU and protect it from particular kinds of imports. DBAM and the carbon border adjustment is an aside. So the question of the price of food is very influenced by the policy, and the cost of food production to the farmer in the UK is influenced by the amount of capital they have involved in the farm, and that includes the farm land price. If land prices go up in Scotland, the rate of return goes down for any crop that's sold. So I think that if I was a farmer in Scotland, yes, I'd find this unnerving because the world is changing underneath me, but I would have found joining the EU pretty unnerving too. But the cornucopia of opportunities in front of me mean that this is a possibility for a really thriving agricultural sector going forward and not a threat to its livelihood, as some of the less informed lobbyists try to present it as.
Okay, I'm aware of time, so I'll leave it there.
We'll now move on to final questions, as we're running out of time, from Beatrice.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you, Professor Helm. It's been a really fascinating, informative session this morning. I've actually got two questions that are slightly different, but I'm going to ask them in the hope that you have time to respond to them. We've talked about competing needs, carbon sequestration and offset. So how can the circle be squared regarding the natural capital and renewable energy? An example would be building wind farms on peatland, which may or may not be degraded. And my final question is really if you could say a bit more about fiscal measures like taxes and levies that can be used to respond to the climate emergency.
Okay, so the second one is well, none of your questions are easy, but the second one is at least has a straightforward answer. You need a price of carbon. Okay, you're not going to get to net zero unless you have a carbon price, and the carbon price should be the same in all sectors of the economy. Start low. Do it very gradual. Takes time for people to adapt. But if not having a carbon price is precisely the wrong answer, almost any incremental carbon price is roughly right and better. Now, there's other whether that feeds through into the price of fertilizer, pesticides, and all sorts of other things, how that works is important. But in the end, it's carbon you're trying to deal with, and therefore it's carbon you should price. Polluters should pay. An efficient economy is where the pollution costs are internalized in the economy. Not to have a carbon price is to distort the economy, and it's to distort trade as well, not to have a carbon border price. On the wind farms versus peat bogs. Okay, so this is quite complex. So in theory, both of them have value, and the wind farm, if it was to go on to a peat bog, should have to pay for all the carbon emitted from the peat bog as a result of their activities. My guess is that would rule out virtually any wind farm on a peat bog. In practice, the peat is so precious and such a global asset that the contribution of individual wind turbines to global warming is not sufficient to offset the value of those peat bogs. Remember, wind is a disaggregated, decentralized, very low energy intensive way of generating electricity. Not to say it shouldn't do it, not to say it isn't desirable to have wind, but given the amount of land in Scotland and given the amount of coastal waters around the United Kingdom, if our efforts of climate change end up with us covering peat bogs with wind farms, then we might as well just admit defeat now and give up. That would be a tragedy of an outcome with no net benefit to global warming and the concentration of carbon in the atmosphere, which we should be addressing. So before you do that, think hard. And remember, when you put a wind farm on fragile soils, you create roads. Fly over the top of any established wind farm. I've recently, looked at the wind farms in Croatia, and you can see all the chalk exposed. And once those roads are there, people will use them, and they will reveal the surface of delicate soils, etc. So just be careful, would be my argument. There are so many sites you could choose, but if I could add a plea right at the end, please leave the peat alone. Or at least try to improve that peat rather than just expose more of it. That would be world leadership as well as good for Scotland.
Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, Karen.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. And I just want to thank you, Sir Helm, for the comprehensive answers you've given today. I found it absolutely fascinating, and my question has shifted every time you've answered, and really I'll come in as a mopping up, sweeping up, so to speak. And I just think, you know, I have so many questions around this, but what I've felt really throughout it all is a very top-down approach. We talk about, you know, the private sector, the public sector. We do talk about people managing the land, but you know, we're looking at we're in an environmental, you know, sensitive time. We talk a lot about, you know, the green economy. I'd like to take you out to sea for a little bit as well. You know, I have a coastal community constituency, the blue economy. But we also have a well-being economy to be thinking of as well, and our good food nation, and all of this combined. And I would just you know, I was a councillor before I was in this position here, and you've spoke about, you know, politicians making these decisions, and I saw a lot of really good localised community action, particularly in times, you know, the storm damage we've had recently, COVID-19, etc. So we've spoke about public ownership, you know, for public good. What about local ownership for local good? What are your views on being a very localised view? I mean, it's the farmers, the fishermen that see the changes, you know, in an environment before anybody else, and that, you know, might know the best way to manage these things. But what's your views on that, on ownership locally?
OK, so the first thing to say is you can't avoid some top-down stuff, OK? Net zero is a top-down target, OK? So it's unavoidable. You have to decide where you're going. That's why we have parliaments. That's why we have governments, OK? But none of this is going to be delivered without the citizens doing the stuff. With due respect to all of you around the table, you're not going yourselves to do much to change the natural environment of Scotland. It's your constituents that are going to do that. So in my little book on net zero, I suggest that it would be a good idea to encourage all citizens to write their own personal carbon diary, not with a eye to precision, but just for everyone to sit down for one day or 2 days and write down all the things they're doing and have a guess at how much carbon's involved in it, and work out roughly what it would mean in 240 or 250 to write that carbon diary with no carbon in it. Think about your breakfast cereal, think about the water in the loo, think about the travel to work, think about the clothes, think about the shoes, think about the flights, think about all the electronic goods, think about your power consumption. And it's us citizens who ultimately buy the stuff. It's us citizens, not companies, that are ultimately the polluters. And we have to change our ways. And that's not to say that we have to have hair shirts and all this stuff our Prime Minister is keen on, but it's us that are going to be on the recipient end of all of this lot. And we have to rewrite that carbon diary. Now, if we do that as communities, bottom up, there is a huge amount of change we can make. Villages can plant their own community woodland. They can have the kids involved in backyard biodiversity. Communities can buy out big landed estates. There are a huge number of ways in which all the multiple dimensions of how we as citizens participate in society that we can make these changes. And you in Scotland are a long way ahead of this. You've had community buyout schemes. I suspect some have worked better than others. I've looked at quite a few in the Outer Hebrides and walked around and had a look and see what people are doing with these opportunities. The community thing is crucial, but when you have community buyouts, you have to work out how continuity is going to work. Most community projects I've seen have immense enthusiasm by people to get them going. That's the easy bit. It's what happens 10, 15, 20 years down the track. And that's why, and it relates to the point I made about trusts owning the carbon offsets, etc. You know, the form of trust, the regulation of those trusts, the way in which they're set up and drive these frameworks so that individuals can not only create these initiatives, but make them happen. And of course, local governments, crucial in that frame too. So I don't want to come over as a top-down Stalinist in this frame. I'm not. There are top-down things that have to be done. But in the end, your question is absolutely apposite. The bottom-up community citizens line of this is important. And remember, we're the people who are going to have to pay. We're the people who are going to have to vote for people who are going to force us to pay, and we're the people who are going to have to change our ways ultimately, because it's us that will drive the electric car rather than the petrol car, not some committee. And so I'm very sympathetic to your question.
Thank you very much. And that brings us to the end of the session. So thank you very much, Professor, for your thought-provoking. And I'm pleased we ended on that optimistic call for action. So once again, thank you for giving us your valuable time. Your contribution is very much appreciated. We'll now suspend the session till 10:45 to allow for a changeover in panellists. Thank you. Welcome back, everybody, and I welcome to our meeting our second panel. We've got Ian Dickey, the Director of Economics for the Environment, Ellie McTaggart, the Chief Exec of Scottish National Investment Bank, Joe Pike, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Wildlife Trust, and Dr. Pat Snowden, the Head of Economics and Woodland Carbon Code from Scottish Forestry. Again, we have approximately 90 minutes for this evidence session, and I'll kick off. Can I ask to what extent that your overall conventional economic thinking has changed in relation to climate and nature emergencies, and also how the concept of natural capital now plays a part in your thinking of the way forward and what opportunities it brings to the rural sector? And if I could kick off with Ian Dickey, please.
Thank you very much for the question. So I think, yeah, conventional economics has become much more aware of environmental economics thinking that FTEC specialises in the last 5 to 10 years, and we're now seeing that applied in how rural economies and the environment are managed. The natural capital framework, I'd say, is very relevant, particularly at a larger scale, and your thinking as a national government. And it's the right framework to think about the long-term management of assets. So Professor Helm was talking about in managing soil as an asset, and that's what natural capital thinking helps you do. It's not necessarily the right framework to communicate policy at a local level, but the principles in natural capital should be part of the thinking. And the other thing I'd say is that applying these things brings lots of new opportunities as well as risks, and those were discussed in the previous session.
Okay, thank you. And can I now ask Ellie McTaggart, please?
Hi, convener. Thank you for the question. I think in the last 10 years, we've seen a massive shift in investment practices across the world, actually. And that's accelerated considerably in the last few years, which is a real benefit to rural economy and investing in natural capital. The focus on ESG principles and positive impacts of investing as well as profit from investing are ever more prominent, and demands from investors are looking for that twin impact and income generated from investment. So I think we've seen it a lot in forestry. I think there's lots to come in peatland regeneration and other natural capital investments. But there's really positive steps towards that coming through with the change and also just increased awareness of the climate change. And ultimately, when people look to net zero and offsetting, I think that's a real opportunity for natural capital and to increase investment into natural capital.
Thank you. And before I move on to the next two, can you also consider we had some comments from Dieter Helm in the previous session about getting natural capital right and assessing it and baselining it, ensuring that we don't plant tens of thousands of hectares of Sitka spruce if that's ultimately in the long term not the best investment, and potentially we need to do all that planning before we bring forward policies. So can I ask Joe Pike, with regards to the Scottish Wildlife Trust, and I'll ask Dr. Snowden the same question, do we need to pause right now, even though we're in a climate emergency, and look to make sure that we are considering a long-term best investment to get the best from our natural capital? So, Joe, initially.
Thank you. I think the urgency of the situation suggests that we probably shouldn't be just pressing the pause button, but I think there are mechanisms in place and processes that we can continue to drive forward that will bring together the range of voices needed to help avoid the unintended consequences that Dieter was talking about this morning. So regional land use partnerships, for example, I think are a really important potential mechanism to embed the principles of natural capital. And as Ian says, it's not necessarily the language that you would use to engage a wider public, but it's such an important fundamental concept. So I think those are already happening, and I think they need support to make them work. So no, you know, sort of advocacy of pauses there. I think, you know, we see discussions about baselining in terms of the future of agricultural payments. There is a huge imperative to move forward in that area. And I think it's about making sure that this is a really inclusive discussion that we have, and making sure that those voices can help surface the risks of unintended consequences to help us avoid them.
Thank you. Just on that, when you say not to pause, we're already seeing potentially extortionate prices for agricultural land, which would normally be passed on to the next generation of farmers or new entrants or whatever, and being snapped up for planting. And we also heard about wind farms potentially being put on peatland. So whilst you say we shouldn't pause, do we need to do more work to ensure that we don't go too far down the road and we do see 25,000 hectares of inappropriate planting of Sitka spruce and so on? So whilst maybe pause is not the right word, do we need to go back and make sure we're doing the right thing? So, Dr. Snowden, where are you with the Scottish Forestry and ensuring that this often used phrase, right tree in the right place, does far more than that? We look at the long-term consequences of actions we're taking just now.
Yeah, thank you, Convener, for the question. Forestry is a long-term business, and at the planning stage, it's normal practice to set out woodland plans for the future, and the right tree in the right place is intended to take a strategic approach to guide local authorities in this as well. But also, if you look at the activities, say, of Forestry and Lands Scotland, who own the state forests in Scotland, they plan their woodlands over many decades ahead. So these things are all intended to ensure a resilient and balanced network of woodlands in the long term. So there are a lot of checks and balances in the system at the moment. I know Professor Helm referred back to the days of the flow country in the 1980s, but a lot has changed in forestry since then. And we have the UK Forestry Standard, which is applied to all projects that we fund, which looks right across the range of benefits that woodlands provide. On the first question, I would totally agree that natural capital is a fundamental change, actually, in how economists look at nature. And I think that's a really good thing. It's mainstreaming nature into economic thinking. And I think that is really needed if the economy is going to work for nature and not against it.
Thank you. We'll now move on to questions from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. We had, as you, I hope, heard a very interesting contribution there from Professor Helm, so I'll unashamedly pick up on some of the themes that he raised. I suppose my first question would really be perhaps for Ailie MacTaggart, and it's what do you make of some of the ideas of a green economy and viewing capital and the natural environment in a different way, not in terms of whether they're right or wrong, because I think there's a growing consensus about that, but how we make that real in the eyes of investors and agriculture and government and everyone else? What's the next step in ensuring that those ideas actually take hold?
Nice. Thank you, Mr. Allen. I think the important thing to sort of note is there is public sector investment and there's private sector investment, and we do need private sector investment to achieve this, and sometimes it gets a lot of criticism, and having come from that in my recent past before I joined the bank a year and a half ago, there is a lot of private sector capital that wants to do purposeful impact investing and get more than just money from its investments, but also get those social impacts and potentially offsets. I think the opportunity is real. I think there needs to be some clever thinking around what that looks like and how you balance off the financial return and the positive impacts for the environment and the local area. In terms of how you do that, forestry has done a good job of that now, obviously, and as the previous commenter just commented, in the 80s and 90s, the type of planting was very different to what it is now, but that shows the evolution and the learning journey. And I think we will have that as we look into peatland restoration and other uses of land. And typically, the use of land is appropriate for the land. I know that when we've been looking into some of this, it's you know, is this arable land? Is this sheep rearing land? Is it land that can be used for anything else? Therefore, it's more appropriate for tree planting. And I think there's a lot of work that I'm sure that the forestry teams are already doing with local authorities on sort of identifying the right land for the right use and for the right return on natural capital, and tying that all in together with either the previous panel discussed a lot about carbon credits and carbon trading and carbon offset. That is a real opportunity, not just for forestry, but for peatland regeneration and also other uses of natural capital. And in some instances, you'll be able to, on you know, in a single farm, you could have some wind turbines and some lease revenue from that. You can have some forestry that is going to provide sustainable building materials in the future. We have to start planting now to ensure we have those sustainable materials in the future, alongside traditional farming of rearing cattle and crops, etc. So I think there's a mixed use there on an individual farm basis, which most of the big farms are very much across and looking to maximise. And from an investment perspective, it's about aggregating and making sure that the investment propositions are sufficiently large, because a lot of the private capital that comes into these is from your big institutional investors, your pension funds, your institutional annuity investors, who typically are looking for a certain scale of their investment, and may not have 1 million to invest, maybe looking to invest 50 or 60 or more, or 100, sometimes 250 million in a project. So, you know, it's about bringing them together and capturing that bigger investment opportunity to access those large pots of capital.
Thank you. And when I asked Professor Helm about land ownership, the interesting reply he came back with was that just because somebody owns something doesn't mean they shouldn't be constrained in what they do with it. Now, I'm not asking you to comment on the big political issues of land ownership, but I am curious to know whether in investment and the attitude that the investment bank would take in rural Scotland, it would have that advice in mind about ensuring that there was some kind of monitoring and ongoing contact with landowners to see how investment was carried out.
Contact with landowners, but it's also contact with other bits of the public sector. From us, we recently came across an investment opportunity, and there was an element of concern around peat on it, and I directed my team to get in touch with Nature Scot to check what they were thinking. We also regularly contact SEPA and our forestry colleagues to ensure that whatever the bank invests in doesn't cut across those larger objectives in terms of what the land should be used for, because that wouldn't be a good use of our capital to cut across those ambitions.
Thank you. And finally, convener, could I ask Joe Pike, again, based on the interesting conversations we've had with Professor Helm, about the concept of rewilding and how you understand that, and where communities fit in when we are handling that concept.
Thank you. I think at the heart of the discussion about rewilding, it's about restoring natural processes in order that our natural environment can recover and support communities to be more resilient, support our well-being and you know, ultimately underpin our economy. So I think it's really important we don't pit the economy against nature. The economy is embedded in nature, and therefore the rewilding story, which inspires huge numbers of people and also puts fear into large numbers of people, it's really important that we have that discussion inclusively. And the language matters less than, you know, the aim to restore nature and ensure that nature recovers all the benefits of the people of Scotland and our economy, because that's it's not an option not to do that.
Okay, thanks, Ed. Jim, you've got a supplementary.
Yes, I have. Thank you, convener. And this one is directed to Eila McTaggart, literally about your role in terms of what is going to be funded. Now, Dieter Helm talked about the possibility of a trust fund, which is based around the investments being made in land in Scotland, done through a trust fund with environmental and sequestration as a prerequisite to what it is that the fund funds, if that makes sense. Do you see the National Investment Bank as being the vehicle so that any private funds that are going to come into land in Scotland come through you and are then distributed in a one-stop shop in order to achieve the environmental desires, rather than it being, as he called it, a Wild West free-for-all?
Thank you, Mr. Frilly, for the question. I think we have a part to play, and we very much are already in conversations around funds or in natural capital with various other public sector partners such as Nature Scotland and others, and there's already been a great amount of work done on that before the bank came into being a year and a bit ago. But the idea that we would funnel everything, I don't think that is necessarily the grand idea. I think we have a part to play. We have some public capital, and we absolutely have the ambition to use that public capital to raise and crowd in other private capital alongside to deliver the missions of the bank, the one we'd be addressing here would primarily be net zero, but also our place mission touches on natural capital and the environment and communities. In terms of the Wild West, I think it's important to recognise that private capital is an important part to play. And some of the previous questions around, land use, designated land use requirements of landowners, et cetera, which are dealt with at a policy level, can help control some of that investment and ensure you don't end up with a Wild West situation where, perfectly good arable land is used for tree planting, et cetera. So there's policy levels and designations there that can help. But we have to recognise that public capital isn't enough to deliver this. We do need private capital. So we need to make sure that it's an attractive enough proposition for private capital to come in. The majority of private capital that comes in is backed up by pension funds or annuity plans or life insurance policy money. A lot of that institutional capital ultimately ends up in a pensioner's pocket. It's being invested to ensure that the pension company can pay out the pension in the future. And so you have to deliver that commercial return for that money to be interested in it. And the great thing that I touched on in my first answer is that in the last 10 years, I've just seen so much advancement in terms of that purposeful investment or impact investment, and so many investors are looking to do more with their money rather than just protect that pension return that they're trying to build. They also want to generate environmental, social benefits with their investments as well. And that is something that we need to try and capture and maximise for investment in Scotland. I think we've got a very important part to play, and I would like to lead in some of the initial funds that are set up from this. But I think if they then spawn future funds, then that is one of the things the bank has been set up to do, which is to lead the way into an investment proposition, establish it, normalise it, and let the private capital step in at that point. That's very much a well-trodden path for development banks. To work in that way, so we come in at the earlier stages, the higher risk stages, and then move on to the next thing once things are normalised.
Thank you. I'll move on to questions from Ariane.
Thank you, Convener. And actually, I just want to kind of continue this theme, but I'll direct my questions to Joe Pike and Ian Dickey. So I'd like to hear your thoughts on how public funding can help to mobilise sources of private funding and whether there are good opportunities to do so within the rural economy. So that's for Joe and Ian.
To come in first.
No, thank you for that. Thank you for that really important question. I think it is really clear to us in all of the conversations that we've had with a really wide range of stakeholders over the last few years, really, but particularly through the Scottish Conservation Finance Project, which brought together different parties, including an expert finance group. People with an interest in nature conservation, people with an interest in enterprise and so on, that the role that the governments can play in the early stages of developing this kind of embryonic new way of looking at how we finance or how we close the finance gap to ensure that we set nature on the road to recovery. Governments play an absolutely critical role in providing a range of support, but investment readiness funding is really, really critical. So we've seen that south of the border, there is an investment readiness fund that has been run by DEFRA, Natural England and others. I think that has provided much needed support and it's enabled innovation. But I think there are lessons being learned from that that we could take on board in Scotland. And I think one of those really important lessons that we're hearing is that actually more support is needed at an earlier stage of the process. So it's already been referred to today that we need to scale up. I think that's really important. But in order for that to happen, we need investment readiness support in Scotland for the really, really early stage conversations that will help start sort of building a pipeline. And then obviously there's huge opportunities and imperatives as well in terms of reforming subsidies in the agricultural space. And I think those two are not necessarily mutually exclusive either.
Thank you. And Ian, do you have any thoughts on that?
Thank you. Yes, well, I agree with that. And I'd say, well, yeah, the public money can help ensure the delivery of public goods through these investments and maintain standards. And on the investment readiness side, I'd say that it can help support maybe some new governance structures that might be needed to ensure investments happen in the interest of local communities. So I think it's interesting that the community buyout process was mentioned in the session with Professor Helm, and that effectively allowed a new governance structure. And with these investments, if we have the investments coming from institutions that are external to Scotland and then the returns going back out of Scotland, that's not a desirable approach and that's not in the best interest of local communities. But there often isn't a kind of organisation that's able to represent the interests of local communities in the investment process. And looking at that elsewhere in the UK, I've been involved in some green investment plans in England, and they're looking to create an institution that can represent community interests in how investments are made, and then also in being a receipt of some of the profits of that investment. And good investments will welcome a party like that representing local community interests, because they'll be in the investment for the long term, and it will help them secure the long-term management of their investments.
Thank you. I'd like to turn to Ailey and ask you about some of the SNIB, Scottish National Investment Bank's direction. So one of the three missions of the Scottish National Investment Bank is supporting a just transition to net zero in 2045 through rebalancing the economy towards leadership in sustainable technology, services and industries. And we heard this morning that agriculture should be a key sector for investment, given the need for a just transition for farmers and innovative new technologies and practices. And I wonder, Ailey, if SNIB, I don't know if that's the correct way to pronounce that, but if SNIB is currently supporting agricultural projects or if it does have plans to do so in the future.
Sure, thank you, Ms. Burgess. Happy to comment. We're just a year and a bit old. We had our first birthday just over a week ago, we've got 10 investments out into the investment universe already, which is fantastic. We've got a number of agricultural linked investments in the pipeline that we're considering, and everything we've looked at vertical farming and other things, different ways to use fish farming and other. Another projects, we're also looking at some sort of supply chain projects in terms of shortening the carbon footprint of food and provenance. I know the previous panel spoke a little bit about carbon footprint. I caught a little bit on, you know, is New Zealand lamb a lower carbon footprint than Scottish lamb, etc., and how to do that. That is something that the world has to get their head around, and there's a lot of thought and progress being put into how one actually identifies that carbon footprint for an individual thing that you're buying off the supermarket shelf. So we are very keen to invest in this. It's a very important part of the Scottish economy, and we're looking for opportunities, and we're seeing a lot of opportunities, which is really encouraging. Nothing closed as yet, but I'm confident if I came back to speak to you this time next year that we would have made some investments into this space. If you could give us a little bit of time to get a little bit further on our journey, that would be fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that response. And I've got a final question, which I would like to direct to Pat Snowden, but also, Ailey, I'd like you to come in on it afterwards. So this committee will soon have the opportunity to scrutinise the budget bill, considering how it will impact on our rural sectors. What should our committee look out for in relation to climate and nature when scrutinising this and future budgets? So maybe we can start with Pat and then come to Ailey.
Yeah, thank you for the question. Well, I mean, we have a Scottish forestry strategy in Scottish forestry, which looks at the sector going forwards and has an implementation plan setting out various things that we aim to deliver, and a number of indicators then which we measure progress against, which include fairly obvious ones like carbon sequestration, but also biodiversity objectives, community objectives, economic objectives. Forestry is quite a far-reaching activity in terms of the things it delivers, so I would recommend that you look across these different indicators that we measure and see the progress that we've made against them. And also, obviously, consider the plans going forward, because some things take time. With the trees, you have to wait for them to grow and deliver. But some of the actions we've already taken will deliver benefits in the future. And I think that's particularly the case when you're looking at carbon.
Oops.
Thank you. Would you like me to come in, Ms. Burgess?
Yes.
Just in terms of budgets and public investment, obviously the bank's been set up to be a slightly different institution to some of the policy teams and enterprise and development agencies that Scotland's had for a long time. In development banks, when we invest, we're very much expecting to get our money back, and the way the bank has been set up is to get our money back and recycle that capital and create hopefully a perpetual fund for Scotland, similar to some of the sovereign wealth funds you might see in other countries. That ambition is built into our DNA as the bank. We're looking for a return on our investments, get our capital back, and also to get emission impacts that will support the missions, one of which you've already touched on. When I look at public sector budgeting and what the bank can do, I think what we need to conversations we need to have, and we already have these a lot with policy teams, and that will develop as we go, is what needs grant funding, what needs sort of what I would call one-way public investment versus what can a development bank or the private sector fund. And it's really about identifying commercially investable propositions and putting commercial investment into them, and whether the bank leads on that and brings additional private capital in is ideal. And that leaves a smaller pot of things that need that grant funding or startup funding or other support, that it is more one way in nature. And it's really about making sure that we're putting the right money into the right projects. And if there is a commercial return available and additional impacts in terms of environmental or net zero, then we capture that and put the right money into it rather than using budget that could be better spent elsewhere. So that's something we're very conscious of working closely with the policy teams on.
Thank you for that. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Now going to bring in Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to touch on we've got the big ideas and the big visions and all the rest of it, but there is some concern that market-based mechanisms such as carbon credits fuel the attractiveness of purchasing land for carbon offsetting, and has got the potential risk to local communities and other land users. And on the 30th of September, the Scottish Parliament held a chamber debate on community wealth and the emergence of green lairds, where the impact of carbon markets on land and land ownership was discussed. Particularly yourself, Ailey, and Pat, how do we avoid this greenwashing by major companies coming into Scotland and buying up that natural capital without any great benefit to the people who live here? Ailey, start with yourself.
Thank you, Mr. Burley. So, I mean, we touched a little bit on that earlier in terms of designation of land. I mean, obviously, green belts have been in existence for decades and have protected places of land around cities that we don't have of constant urban sprawl. And so there are ways to protect and designate land and also work with investors to use the right land for the right thing. And it's about intelligent and use of land. And I think I touched on earlier, you know, not using arable land for forestry, for example, and looking to use alternative land that isn't suitable for crops.
Sorry, Ellie.
So I think there's something that can be done there.
Sorry, Jim wants to just intervene.
I'm just going to interrupt you very quickly on that point.
Oh, sure.
Therefore, given what you've just said, do you believe then that we should have land grades as the prerequisite for what is going to be planted? Are you suggesting that good quality arable land shouldn't be used for tree planting? And are you going for specific grading of land for specific investments?
Above my pay grade as chief executive of the bank, there's some policy teams that would be better versed in answering and that sort of designation. I know that when we look at investing in forestry, we look at the type of land they're looking for, and it wouldn't make sense to plant trees necessarily on arable land as an investor. In terms of how the government wants to manage its land and work with landowners to use the land for the best appropriate use, I think that's something that the policy and government policy and regulation, if needed, can drive. As I mentioned, Greenbelt is a form of regulation that's been around for decades. I'm not prescribing it for myself because there's many other people who are better advised on that in terms of what that could look like. But it is something that investors take into account. Most investors are very conscious of what their money does, and there's been a lot of debate on greenwashing, and most of the big institutional investors are very conscious of trying not to do that. Some people will, you know, there's no you know, perfect solution here. However, if you look at, I think I'm talking about rewilding and peatland regeneration, you know, are there, you know, other ways we can use that to create those carbon offsets and trading and really get that benefit out of regenerating our peat and offsetting carbon versus, you know, cannibalising farmland or other areas on tracts of land. So I think there's a number of areas that interact to manage this in the country and work with private landowners to ensure the best thing happens for the country as a whole. And one of the other panellists just touched on community benefit funds and investments and trusts, and those are all fantastic ways to ensure that the community benefits from some of this investment as well. And typically, some of the larger private sector investors welcome that community connection with their investment. We've seen that in some of the green energy work that's already happened in the country.
That does kind of come back to the earlier point that I raised with you that Dieter Helm mentioned about having a trust fund kind of an organisation that makes those kind of investment decisions. And I get what you're saying, that you don't have the expertise to deal in that. But it does kind of raise the question that, what is it we're trying to achieve? We want to achieve net zero, we want to achieve return for investors, and we want to be able to keep people on the land. So it seems to me there needs to be some kind of mechanism for us to be able to bring all of that together. And I'm sorry, that's just a statement, that's not a question to yourself, Ellie.
Can I maybe come in the back of that? And it is a question for Ellie. I know you're saying it's maybe above your pay grade or whatever, but is there a level of ethical decision that the National Investment Bank should be looking at in the same way that there may be an economic argument to cut down rainforests in Brazil and create cattle lots? In the long term, should the Scottish National Investment Bank be looking at investments into forestry planting, which, yeah, absolutely, there's private sector money there to be invested, but we're seeing land right now in Scotland being overpriced and agricultural, farmers being priced out of the market because of the astronomical prices that private investors are willing to pay to plant trees. And we're seeing, as Jim touched on, land classified as 3.2, which would normally be for agriculture production, now being assumed as being suitable for planting trees. Is that not something that you should consider when you decide on the investments that you might make. Can I ask you that question, but also the same question to Ian Dickie?
We take a huge number of factors into account when we're considering our investments. The primary one for development, and this applies to all development banks, including us, we were initially set up under the EU state aid rules. We had to have those permissions before we could launch last year. Obviously, those things are changing with substitute control changes post-Brexit. But one of the sort of fundamental factors of development banks is that you don't invest where the private sector is investing, because that's not a good use of your money. So when we invested in a recent investment in Gresham Forestry Fund, that was a different type of forestry fund. In recent years, forestry funds have been later life forestry investments focused on harvesting. The Gresham Fund was focused on planting and woodland creation. It was struggling to raise money from the private sector because it had a longer horizon for its return on investment. And it was a new type of forestry investment that hadn't been done before. And so when they approached us, we spoke to them and said, look, have you spoken to the private sector? There's typically a lot of investment available for forestry. And they said, no, it's because we're looking to plant and a longer horizon for that investment to come through than Gresham's previous forestry investments. So we did a lot of work with them to ensure that our capital was required to establish and cornerstone that fund, and it's now increasingly attractive to other investors now that we've cornerstoned it. And that is a key role that development banks play everywhere. You see the EIB play it. There's a number of other development banks across Europe and the world that do this, and we're following that model in those investments. We're very careful about how we invest and land grades, and obviously there's some of the designations you talk about are essentially a regulation in terms of land use and in terms of the pricing of agricultural land and versus planting land. I don't know off the top of my head the economics of that, but particularly for the fund that we've invested in, it's looking at land that isn't typically going to be able to be used for other forms of agriculture, and it's the lower quality land that is more suited to forestry. And that was something that we did discuss with them in detail at the time of the investment.
Thank you for that. And can I ask Ian Dickie for his comments before moving to Jenny for her set of questions?
Thank you. Yeah, I thought the questions revealed quite an interesting problem about the information you have to make these decisions. So as was pointed out, if investments are made only for the purpose of carbon markets or carbon sequestration, you're getting land use that you don't think is in the wider interest of Scotland. But similarly, if you only make those decisions based on land grades for agriculture, you ignore some environmental issues. That means you might not get the right decision. But what you need to do is join that information up. And that's what we did in the study in the Tweed that's referenced in the papers for this meeting, is combine a series of rich data sets that were already in place, but they weren't integrated and they weren't linked to socioeconomic information. So you've got the various purposes being talked about in this meeting, continuing agricultural production, new carbon markets and green investments, net positive for biodiversity, maintaining a community interest. If you have a different set of information on all those and other issues, and they're not interconnected, then it's very hard to make decisions that serve the best combined purpose for
Thank you very much.
Scotland. But it is possible to join that data up and an economic activity that comes as a result. So recognising agricultural production value and the tourism value and the value to local communities, for example, in terms of public health.
Thank you. That's very useful. Rachel Hamilton.
Can I ask Pat Snowden how the Woodland Carbon Code measures reduction in emissions?
Yes, thank you for the question. Well, it's the fundamental thing that it does. The estimates are based on tree growth models, which Forest Research, our research agency, have developed since the 1960s. And these models were expanded to look at the whole biomass of the tree in order to estimate the carbon content for different species, different yield classes under different management regimes. They're the same carbon models that are used in the UK's greenhouse gas inventory. At the same time, we also take account of emissions from soil on planting, depending on how the trees are planted and what type of soil has been planted on. The models also account for any emissions associated with planting activities, so harvesting activities, things like this. So it's a comprehensive carbon model that looks at all the, not just the sequestration, but also any emissions associated with forestry activities. And projects can put in their plans for planting their woodland, including their species and yield classes, etc. And the model will provide estimates for them over time at five-year intervals of how much carbon, net carbon sequestration will take place for that project. And this model is available on our website, and it's used by all projects that are being established.
Dr. Snowden, do you believe that private investors are put off by the return on investment on hardwood planting such as oaks and beeches, which take a lot longer to return that investment than Sitka spruce?
Well, obviously, species such as Sitka spruce grow more quickly, and they are well suited to the climatic conditions in this country. So, from a commercial perspective, that is a more attractive timeline in many cases. The hardwood market is not as developed, but there are opportunities in hardwood. People are trying to take advantage of that, but obviously the softwood investment has been the dominant model in the commercial sector.
And so would it be your recommendation that corporate companies that are looking to offset carbon, who don't actually reduce their emissions, that they are encouraged to invest in hardwoods rather than Sitka spruces, and to look very much at the reduction in their emissions on top of the carbon offsetting that they're doing?
Well, we have a statement at the beginning of our, at the front of our website, saying that, you know, companies should follow an emissions mitigation hierarchy. That the first thing they should do is reduce their emissions, and offsetting should be the last thing that they do. And the code, the Wooden Carbon Code, is there to provide confidence that when they do get to that offsetting stage, that it's been done in the right way. So we've based the code around international standards on that, such as the Gold Standard and VERA, which are the world's two leading standards. We don't make specific recommendations to companies, you know, in under the Wooden Carbon Code about softwood or hardwood production. The one important thing I would say about timber production in relation to the Wooden Carbon Code is that it significantly reduces the amount of carbon credits that can be claimed. Broadly speaking, you can only claim about a third of the number of credits you have a commercial woodland under the code compared to a woodland that's left there permanently. So there is a trade-off between carbon, because obviously on harvest you're taking carbon out of the woodland. So that's that will to some extent deter commercial investment in the Wooden Carbon Code woodlands. And it explains why the majority of projects, roughly three quarters of projects under the Wooden Carbon Code to date that have been validated, are mixed broadleaf and generally mixed woodlands.
Okay, can I turn to Ailie McTaggart, please? We know that government intervention incentivizes natural assets and drives up the value of carbon pricing, and that's created a gold rush to buy land to offset carbon credits. So how does the Scottish National Investment Bank measure the value to the public taxpayer in terms of reducing emissions and sequestrating carbon?
Thank you, Ms. Hamilton. It's a good question. The value of investment versus carbon reduction is something that impact investors have been looking to quantify for a long time. We will look into, as I've said before, the use, the designated use of the land, and and ensure that our investment, and we have an ethical investment policy and very detailed discussions on these in our first stage investment committee process before we make any investment, to determine that ensure that our capital is deployed in the most responsible manner possible. It's a growing field of investment, and I think what we need to be careful is that we do take advantage of it in Scotland, because that money is needed to regenerate peat, to rewild, to ensure that we have sustainable building materials in the future, and also to ensure that we are, as a country, hitting net zero as well. But again, it comes back to sort of this. What I'm seeing is a bit of a theme of this discussion is what land is right for what purpose, and I think that's a combination of us. Whenever we do investments, we speak with the policy teams within Scottish Government and sometimes within UK Government as well, to ensure that the investments we're making aren't cutting across any policy or causing these issues, and that we are alive to these issues by having those discussions regularly and interacting with ministers such as yourselves on a regular basis as well. So there's not one single solution I can give for that, other than that we're very aware, very conscious of what our investment does and looking to, you know, primarily deliver our missions. That's why we were set up, and as a development bank investing where others don't invest, so that we can encourage that investment in the future. It's a very tricky space to manage, and to touch on the previous point in terms of reducing first is absolutely there, but reducing emissions takes time, and so providing investors with opportunities to offset while they're reducing their emissions and while the countries and the world is moving away from a dependency on oil and gas is really important, and actually an opportunity for us in Scotland to gather that investment in to help us do that as a country as a whole. So, you know, there's not one single spot here, and I think Mr. Fairley mentioned something earlier that sort of tied up the need to look at this in the round and every investment that you're doing. And that's why we work very closely with the policy teams.
And finally, to Ellie McTaggart, your aim with SNB is to sustain 200 jobs and create 500 additional jobs. Do you know how many jobs have been created through the £50 million investment so far?
I don't, but I can follow up with committee on that. It's changing daily, but the £50 million investment hasn't been fully invested yet. It's drawn over time as they purchase land and invest, and the 200 was a total over the time. But I'll follow up with the answer on that to date. It is very early days, because we just did the investment. The fund's just been set up, and so. Working towards that.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to questions from Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for panel for joining us this morning. During COP, I attended a couple of fringe events, and one was on the Global Biodiversity Strategy, and it talked about protecting, restoring and enhancing biodiversity. I'd like to direct my question to Joe Pipe, because I was interested in the Scottish Wildlife Trust's funding opportunities outlined, and just wondered how that route map was progressing and how, you know, how much interest you've received in that.
Thank you for that question. So when the route map was published last year, which we published jointly with the Scottish Environment Protection Agency, with input from a huge variety of stakeholders, it was really encouraging to see a massive amount of interest, actually, including from some of our international stakeholders, who told us that they felt it added new to the discussion, as well as obviously trying to bring together some of the things that were already happening, and, you know, across a range of innovative levies, innovative loans, innovative investment opportunities. So there were 9 pathways within the document that was created, and each of those is owned by different stakeholders. You know, the Scottish Wildlife Trust and SEPA provided that space for the conversations to come together and those pathways to be defined. So I can sort of home in on a couple of them. So, for example, the Nature Climate Bond was an innovation that took place as a direct result of the £1 billion challenge that we ran. But it built on an existing model that has been developed by Abundance Investment, which is working with a number of local authorities south of the border to deliver climate-related impacts, so to things like LED lighting and carbon reduction strategies. They provide an opportunity for ordinary citizens to engage in the process through a sort of crowdfunding investment platform. And what we looked at through the £1 billion challenge was how do you bring nature into that picture in order that you can tackle the nature and climate crises together, which I think is, you know, enormously important. I mean, Ian was talking before about, you know, the importance of being joined up. And as Ailey said, that kind of policy coherence is really important. But quite often it's harder to see the monetizable elements of the nature part of the picture than it is to see the carbon reduction strategies. So the fundamental idea there is that if you bundle them together, take something like sustainable urban drainage systems, which the Scottish Wildlife Trust was engaged in a few years ago in Cumbernauld, for example, with Scottish Water. You're investing in the creation of habitat for wildlife, a series of ponds in this case, which is actually providing economic benefits through improved water filtration, lower pollution costs and so on. It can obviously help flooding impacts as well. So looking at how you bring these two things together and, you know, rather than kicking the can down the road with the things that are a bit harder to finance, how can you, you know, understand that the two have to be sort of part of the picture from the word go. So I spoke to Edinburgh City Council the other day, and they're leading on this, but it would be replicable across other local authorities in Scotland. And so it's just been built into their climate strategy for 2050 that's just been approved by councillors, and it's going to a committee in the new year. So obviously there has been a bit of a hiatus due to the pandemic. So that's one really good example where, you know, it doesn't happen overnight, but there's massive potential there. And across a whole range of the other pathways, I would highlight maybe a couple of others. So, for example, the Natural Capital Pioneer Fund, which is a concept that's been developed by a company called Conservation Capital, that is in really urgent need of an investment readiness facility. So that's basically ready to go. Conservation Capital are already engaged in all sorts of other things worldwide. But Neil Burney, who heads them up, is based in Scotland. This is an opportunity in Scotland that's ready to go if we can, as a nation, put in place this investment readiness support. And there are investors lined up to kind of match public funding, if you like. The one final one I'll mention is the invasive species pathway, which I think is a really, really important opportunity that at the moment is not going anywhere because it's not at a stage where there is sufficient resource to make it of interest to the commercial players. So the idea was inspired by conversations through the £1 billion challenge with people who'd been involved in the early stages of climate finance, you know, maybe 15 years ago. And one of the penny dropping moments for them was the idea that, you know, to finance, you know, renewable energy sources or ground source heat pumps and that kind of thing would be to put in place finance whereby you take out a loan, you buy your new sort of low carbon heating system, and you pay back the loan based on the savings that generates for you. And that seems really obvious to us all now. But we don't apply that kind of thinking to invasive non-native species, which on the one hand cost the Scottish economy an enormous amount of money every year. I can't remember how much. I think a report that's over a decade old said it was something like £20 million every single year. That will be, you know, probably bigger now and will get worse with climate change. But the science is telling us with invasive non-native species that we should be moving from this constant management, which is costly in itself and doesn't get to the root of the problem, to prevention. So if we can apply the same thinking, and Lloyds Bank were really, really interested in this, but it's another example of where you need that kind of early public funding to put in place some resource to just move it forward to the next stage before it becomes properly of interest to sort of commercial players. And there's lots of things happening across the other six pathways. I won't go into those just now. Riverwoods is a project that the Scottish Wildlife Trust is leading on, which is developing blended finance principles. And you heard Professor Helm earlier talking about the importance of river catchments and Riverbank Woodlands. So happy to provide any further information on any of the other mechanisms.
Thank you, Jo. I'm aware of the rhododendron ponticum that there's investment going into. So the key word was rhododendron there.
Sorry, I don't know. We lost connection there just for a minute. I'm going to ask Jenny to ask her question again.
Sorry, I was commenting there, Jo, on rhododendron ponticum, and I know that's been there's investment to clear that to avoid the ongoing work to clearing. I suppose my next question then, perhaps, given what Jo has just been talking about, is to Ailey at the bank about how we're ensuring that private funds achieve the right outcomes and how the bank is supporting that. So the right outcomes for climate and nature, if that makes sense. I was thinking...
For the bank, we're unique in that we will only invest where we get an outcome that... It's commercial investment, so we can recycle our capital and create that perpetual fund, but also addresses one of our emissions. Increasingly, we see our net zero emission as a bit of a common. A lot of general principal investment in net zero, and one of the investments I'm quite proud of is in our investment in the mid-market rent fund to provide affordable housing for key workers and others close to town, in the PFP fund. In making that investment, we encourage the fund manager to improve the energy efficiency of their buildings and drive that net zero agenda there. That has two positive outcomes. One is that the people that live in their affordable rent properties have lower bills for the long term, and obviously the better outcome is for the planet as well in terms of a more energy efficient building. So all of those things we take into account in everything that we do. As I've mentioned a few times, increasingly a lot of private sector investors are looking to do that. You've seen NatWest announce billions to invest in sustainable finance, and you've just heard Jo mention Lloyds, and there's all the big institutional investors like Allianz and Legal & General, and all the big pension funds, Strathclyde, Lothian, all of them in Scotland, as well as bigger ones, Royal Mail and others, and across the country, who are really keen to embrace that purpose investment along with their income that they need to generate to cover their pension liabilities. So it is something that we do solely. We won't invest unless we get emission impact from it. And that's one of the key bases of that Mariana Mazzucato came up with in supporting the design of the bank. Others increasingly are doing it, not solely as the bank is, but we talk about our emissions as almost our first filter for investment. When we see an investment, we look to see which of our emissions it supports or addresses. And as I've said, the net zero emission is increasingly a common theme across all of our investments.
Okay, thank you.
Just before I bring in Rachel and Jim, I get a feeling that investors are treading water at the moment. You know, I mentioned there's a bit of a pause where it's not entirely clear where the money should be invested to get the best return in terms of climate change and biodiversity. And, we heard from Professor Helm talking about we needed to look at river catchment and base some of our work on that. And of course, non-native invasive species plays a role in that. And I know, Ian Dickey, you've done a lot of work in looking at what the state of natural capital is at the borders, with a whole range of things: woodland creation, habitat creation, flood management, farmland management. So you're baselining, and that's in the borders. Do we need to do that across the whole the country before we actually know where we should be investing? We've also had a fairly critical report from the CCC that suggests there is absolutely no detail on the policies that underpin the Scottish Government's ambitions to reach net zero by 2045. That's also creating uncertainty. So do we need government to come forward with baselining and putting some meat on the bones of the policies before we do get investment in the right areas? Ian, can I come to you first and then Ailey, please?
Thank you, Convener. I mean, basically, yes. I would say for a couple of reasons. Firstly, if you're not measuring baseline accurately, then it's hard to know what extra impact you're going to have with any public policies or spending. And it's harder for investors to know what impact their investments are going to have. And you want a bit of consistency in how that's done, so you can compare your investment options in the borders, you know, to the Central Belt, to the Highlands, on a broadly consistent basis. What I'd also say is that establishing that baseline doesn't involve really that much original work. What it does involve is connecting together existing data sets better. And I know the case, particularly in England, is that often there's been separate data used by the agencies giving out agricultural subsidies to those managing biodiversity impact, and that leads to separated decision making. And I've seen that in private sector as well, having one data set that's used to determine net positive for biodiversity and a different data set used to measure carbon impacts of changes in land management. You've got to join that data up. It already exists in different forms, but it's not joined up, then you can't make an integrated sort of multi-purpose decision.
Thank you. And Ailey?
Thank you. The journey to net zero is going to be a difficult one. I mean, the reason that the bank's vision is set to 2045 and governments are looking to those long targets is that it's not something we can achieve in the next 5 years. I think policy will build generally over time and become more fulsome and capture some of the things that Ian has just talked about, in that there's quite a lot of, there are a lot of individual data points that gathered, and it's about capturing them and ensuring that they aren't working against each other in any way, which what Ian was directing his comments to. It's going to be iterative. Nobody has the perfect solution yet. If we did, everybody would be doing it across the globe. And one of the good things about the climate emergency is bringing companies at COP, you saw that so much, and companies and governments together to try and work out how we achieve this, because nobody has the sort of the magic wand to make it happen. It's going to take a generation at least, and then potentially longer, and to change the world and how it relies on oil and gas and moves to more sustainable. So I think every government is faced with a challenge here and will continue to have to build those policies and learn from each year and each decade of transition how to do it better and also look to each other to influence and learn. And we do that certainly with other development banks and speaking to them all the time about what they've done in their journeys and learning from them. And I'm sure that my policy colleagues in government do the same to interact and ensure that we get the best solution. But, as the bank, we have, $2 billion, which is a lot of money, but it's not enough to address this by itself, which is why we are looking to encourage that private sector capital and alongside us in every investment we make, because it is such a large challenge and it requires so much investment to get us there.
Thank you. Jim's got a supplementary before I move to Karen.
Yeah, I'm still not 100% clear, maybe I'm missing something, on where private investment gets a return when investing in carbon without the market having to be highly regulated. And are we in danger of creating another a repeat of when we had subsidy quotas in farming? People were started to trade in quota rather than in in livestock or in whatever it was. They were selling quota. We created a whole new economy of quota. And one of the things that I'm going to go back to our evidence session on November 24th. We had David Finlay from the Ethical Dairy. He says his dairy is sequestering 5 tonnes per hectare per year. They're emitting 4.5 tonnes per hectare per year. So according to AgriLac, if they were to sell that 5 tonnes of carbon, he's no longer net zero himself. And he doesn't understand how the industry can sell carbon without becoming carbon positive. And we also heard from the chair of the Scottish Land Commission, who said, we've had a number of concerns raised recently from people across different land use sectors and stakeholders of the Tenant Farming Advisory Forum about the pressures farmers and crofters are facing to sign over their carbon rights. It's a fledgling market and there's a risk decisions are being made without full awareness of the implications for individual land managers. I would encourage landowners and land managers to exercise caution when considering transferring carbon rights or options until there is greater clarity over issues such as ownership of the rights and the need to retain them in offsetting their own emissions in the future. And I know, Ellie, you said that this is a fledgling industry, but isn't that all the more reason to make sure that we get this right?
I agree. We have to try and get it right. And the comment at the end of that paragraph that you read out in terms of companies and individual farmers or landowners looking to almost create their own net zero before they start trading some of their carbon credits with others, it is absolutely right as far as I'm concerned. I mean, even in the bank's portfolio, we're looking at the corporate sustainability of the portfolio as a whole and every investment we make. Many corporates are on that journey and governments are on that journey as well in terms of how you do that. We absolutely have to try and get it right. I'm not sure there is a perfect solution, though I think there will be an element of trial and error as we try and build this. And as long as everybody's pushing in the right direction and we are getting those reductions and looking to use responsible methods for offsetting, obviously the trading of quotas and everything you talked about, I'm not hugely aware of, but it isn't the sort of market one would want to create with this. But there is a place for offset while we reduce emissions to get us to net zero, because that's just the journey that we're on over the next 25 plus years. And you know, whether we will all achieve our goals of the 25 years is something that we will only know in 25 years' time. But it is a long window for the general public to understand. And I think we need to sort of break it down into what we can achieve in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years to try and get the general public more understanding of what a journey to net zero is. Because to them, it seems like a very long time at the moment.
I have to say, I see real barriers in the way to the carbon trading side of this. If a farmer is net zero, he doesn't have anything to sell. He's net zero. If he's got surplus, then you can trade it. And I just think we need to be very careful with this. Sorry, Convener, I'm hogging the mic.
No, that's fine. Pat would like to come in this, and I'm going to bring Rachel in for a brief supplementary before moving to Karen.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks, Mr. Fairley, for the question. I point out that the Wooden Carbon Code at the moment hasn't really got into what you might call a secondary market. The transactions are all done over the counter, directly between investors and either intermediaries or landowners directly. The majority of our schemes have been quite small, and we are under pressure now to look at the secondary market issues, and so we are considering that, but treading quite carefully, I would say. And also IHS Markit, who run our carbon registry, they're based in New York, are also quite cautious about this. So it's a natural progression, perhaps, for the market to think about moving from just where we are with over-the-counter sales into some form of secondary market. But we're not really there yet, and we're thinking quite carefully about whether it's the right thing to do. You raise an important point about farmers and accounting, and the challenge here is that a carbon credit can only be used once by one entity. You know, it can't be used by two. So you're absolutely right that if the farmer sells a credit, he or she cannot use it themselves. And so that is, I recognise the challenge for that. But yes, at the end of the day, a credit can either contribute to reducing the farmer's footprint or to somebody else's, but not both. But I understand the point you raise.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
It's a question for Joe. Joe, you were talking about the River Woods, which is the conservation covenant that's being looked at in England and Wales right now. Are you aware of any Scottish Government funding for riparian tree planting?
So, first of all, River Woods is broader than the idea of covenants. We looked at covenants which are used in other places, but it's exploring the full range of ways of financing riparian restoration. So at the moment, obviously, through the existing forestry grant scheme, there are mechanisms to enable people to do planting. One of the conversations that we've had with stakeholders recently is whether there are ways that that could be optimised or even indeed better communicated. There might be certain things that are possible that people are not currently aware of. But we're also looking at a model based broadly on something called the Forest Resilience Bond from the States, and that's predicated on reducing the costs of forest fires. So if you look here in Scotland, reducing the costs of flooding would be the parallel, and looking essentially at the interventions for nature to deliver the nature-based solutions, so that, you know, planting and restoring of riparian areas with good baselines in terms of, you know, mapping out the opportunities to increase connectivity, you know, as much as possible. So then from that list of interventions that you make for nature, you've got a whole list of benefits that flow from that. So in this case, improved flood protection, but also things like water temperature regulation. So Professor Helm earlier on talked about the whisky industry. You know, that's certainly of material consideration to them, but for salmon fisheries as well, water temperature is a really critical issue, which will become even more important with climate change. But you've also got other benefits such as reduction of soil erosion and carbon benefits and so on. So the third list, if you like, is the list of beneficiaries in relation to those benefits. And then the fourth list is kind of a subset of that, which is those beneficiaries that would be willing and able to pay over a long period of time in order to realise those benefits. And that's how the Forest Resilience Bond was built. They're kind of much further ahead than we are. But, you know, looking at whether it's local authorities, whether it's whisky companies, whether it's Scottish Water, obviously, is a key stakeholder there. So and there will be parts of the systems that can be financed like that and parts that can't.
Joe, if I was a landowner right now and I wanted to cool my waters and increase the salmon population, could I apply for a fund with the Scottish Government for riparian tree planting?
I think, I mean, beyond the... I'd let Pat sort of respond to the detail of exactly what you can get through the current forestry grant scheme. But what we're trying to do with Riverwoods is help sort of scale up that thinking to catchment scale, where we can maximise those opportunities for landowners to work together and deliver nature networks. I mean, that's, I guess that's the heart of this, the commitment in, you know, to nature networks in every local authority in Scotland, actually, in terms of the best use of public money. If we can think about nature networks across the whole of Scotland, riparian networks are a brilliant example of that. And as a colleague of mine often says to me, you know, we wouldn't ever build a road or we wouldn't ever expand the rail network without knowing what it's going to link up to. So I think we need to just start thinking about nature in that way as well. And a lot of that, you know, that's critical to the sort of concept of Riverwoods, if you like.
Thank you. Now move to Karen.
Thank you, Convener. My question is really directed at Ian, and it's in terms of the characterisation report, noting the main opportunities for investment here. I suppose I've got a question in two parts. Was this looked at in a holistic way? I mean, particularly during COVID, we did see quite a lot of farms, you know, diversifying into agritourism, for example. And, you know, having that focus, I know that's, you know, we're talking about natural capital here, but also, you know, coming from a localised view, who were the stakeholders within this? I have, and I know this isn't natural capital, but I do have, there's a coach company that's within my constituency, and I'm not advertising, Convener, don't worry, I won't give away names here, who are really trying hard, you know, to encourage people out of their cars and into coach travel, for example, for tourism, to access what we would call, you know, our natural capital. So in terms, we could probably call them facilitators. Were they included within this as a stakeholder, and were these main opportunities seen as you know, seen in a holistic sense?
Yes, I'd say we were trying to look at the holistic sense of joining together all the different interests in the natural environment. The data we were using really originates from pre the COVID pandemic. So the changes that's brought to how people use the environment aren't reflected in that work, and probably quite difficult to build into work even now, because we don't always have a clear picture of how behaviours might have changed and might change going forward. We did think about the visitor economy and the opportunities around that, and visitors' visits to the natural environment have benefits to local people in terms of their well-being and health, and then from visitors from outside an area bring expenditure. So it's an important visitor economy, and we did try to include those things. We didn't look further down the sort of supply chain in the different sectors, so to include the transport companies, but the value of the activities that looked at reflects the opportunities for service providers like people in transport. And we did try to reflect the different stakeholders in those things. So when we look at that information, obviously we join together environmental data and we link that to calculations which reflect an economic value of different benefits to society. But in doing that, we also consider the distribution of those benefits across society, across different groups in society now, and also between current and future generations. And I think that's a really important practical point about the natural capital approach, is it looks at the environment as an asset and what it can provide into the future. And there's an interesting contrast between the 5- and 10-year investment processes just been referred to, but a lot of environmental assets, to appreciate their full benefit, you have to look 50 or even 100 years into the future. And you want a consistent basis for doing that. So you want to consider the value of agricultural land. If it's going to change in use, there's an opportunity cost of lost production. You want to consider that consistently from different areas of land. And similarly for other opportunities, if they're going to provide benefits, you need the full time scale to calculate their full value to society.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now move on to Beatrice.
Thanks, convener. My questions addressed firstly to Ian, and then if other members want to come in, that would be helpful. I wonder if you could say a bit about how fiscal measures like taxes or levies could be used in responding to the nature and climate emergency, and also as drivers for changing behaviour. Professor Helm talked about polluters should pay and having a carbon price. And then how could taxes and levies be used in both the rural and marine economies?
So I agree with Professor Helm that getting the price of carbon right is important. Came from one thing said earlier, saying, you know, people paying for carbon offsets effectively acts as an incentive for them to reduce their emissions. So it's not an either or. So FTEC, as a small business, we buy an offset for our unavoidable emissions, and that's a cost, that's a reduction in our profit, and that gives us an incentive to work in the lowest carbon way possible. And I think we do that. There are opportunities, yeah, to use economic instruments. I wouldn't say it's just taxes or levies. So one thing to appreciate about these different environmental markets is they're driven by regulations. So unless there's a regulatory target that people are trying to comply with, there won't be an environmental target. There won't be an environmental market emerge for people to find ways to deliver that target. And that's the case with carbon emissions, and it's also the case with the biodiversity net gain market starting to be formed in England. And those markets need good regulations and good rules to function well. There are opportunities to use economic incentives like that, but there's also an important role in those for regulation to maintain minimum standards, which, as Pat mentioned, you know, there are screening processes for ensuring now that forestry creation happens in the right place, and those sort of minimum standards should be maintained alongside the operation of environmental markets.
Would anybody else like to address the concept of taxes, fees and levies being used? No. What I would like to ask, is it not really difficult to talk about these sort of things and regulations, whatever, when we do hear that, particularly when it comes to agricultural strategy, the CCC has said that there are ambitious or big ambitions, but there is nothing to demonstrate we might deliver on them because there's no clear strategy in place for achieving them. So I suppose we can't start talking about fiscal measures if we don't actually know what the direction of travel is. Is that the issue where we are at the moment? We don't actually know what the policies to deliver on climate change and biodiversity loss are, as has been quite clearly pointed out by the CCC at the beginning of this week. Can I ask, Dr. Snowden initially?
Thank you, Convener. Well, I can talk from a forestry perspective that Scotland obviously has a climate change plan which was updated in the last couple of years, and it looks right across the economy at how different sectors will meet Scotland's climate change targets. And in forestry, we set out increased planting targets to help meet that ambition. There's also an objective in there to increase the use of timber in construction. And we aim to match our funding to those requirements and to achieve those targets over time. And in terms of instruments, then it's not just about grant support. It is also about the Wood and Carbon Code as an incentive to increase planting. The key factor underlying the Wood and Carbon Code is this concept of additionality in carbon markets, whereby it targets projects that wouldn't have gone ahead in the absence of the sale of carbon credits. So there's a number of different instruments which are being used in the forestry sector to help meet those targets within the resources that we have. And Ian may wish to comment, but there has been no work by FTEC to look at the funding gap for meeting targets in the future. And measures such as the Wood and Carbon Code, which can lever in additional private finance, are going to be really important to meeting targets.
Thank you. And Jo has indicated she'd like to come in this one.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of that big picture and the clarity of the direction of travel, the science is quite clear. You know, in terms of biodiversity loss, there are five well-recognised drivers of biodiversity loss. So whilst there are areas of uncertainty and you know, there's a data gap, there's a finance gap, there's an implementation gap, and all of those require effort and resource simultaneously, I would suggest. I think it's important to recognise that, you know, there are things that we have available to us at the moment that can help us move forward. And just going back to the advisory group on economic recovery, which Professor Helm was part of, and the recommendations that they put forward to the Scottish Government, you know, one way of building in this holistic approach where we do get this joined up way of dealing with climate change and biodiversity loss is by taking, you know, what they call a four capitals approach. So we're talking about natural capital. Traditionally, our economies are based on financial capital. But if we think about financial, human, social and natural holistically and build that into the economic strategy, I think there's a real opportunity there for Scotland to play a leadership role. And I actually think there's something for us to learn from the pandemic in terms of the developments of vaccines and the fact that everybody thought that, you know, it would take 10 years. And when you look at the kind of critical path that, you know, things that need to happen to tackle the environmental emergency that we're in, I think we probably need to challenge our thinking about what has to happen sequentially and what can actually happen in parallel. And that's how they solved the vaccine problem, by kind of breaking the rules and saying, well, actually, we can start manufacturing vaccines before we've got regulatory approval. We can, you know, have certain things happening together. So I think in terms of that big picture, I would say that's a really important lesson. And I think when the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy is developed next year, that will be hugely important. And the creation of nature targets that have been committed to, I think that will put nature and climate change targets on a par. And I think it's hugely helpful that the First Minister has you know, publicly acknowledged that those two things need to be tackled together. I think that's crucial.
Thank you. And finally, a supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
I go back to Pat Snowden, isn't it? Just on the point there about the sectoral pathways, they are not policies as such as yet, particularly in agriculture, and therefore there is no way to actually, as the Climate Change Committee said, to measure emissions. So therefore that is a very difficult position for land users or landowners to be in. I just want to go back to the point I made about riparian tree planting. Has the Scottish Government implemented any funding strategy to incentivise people to plant riparian trees?
Yes, Scottish Forestry dispenses a range of grants to different woodland types, and that does include planting along in riparian areas. Actually, the Riverwood scheme isn't just confined to planting right by rivers. It's a bit further away from them as that, and they're looking into floodplains and surrounding areas. But I'd be happy to send the committee further details of all our grant schemes and the different types of woodlands that are supported under them.
Thank you.
That would be helpful.
Thank you very much. And that brings this session to end. I would like to thank the panel for their evidence and their responses to the questioning. We will now briefly suspend until 10:20. Thank you. 12:20, beg your pardon. Okay, our second agenda item two is subordinate legislation. And it's the Private Storage Aid Scheme Pig Meat Scotland Regulation 2021, SSI 2021-398. And this instrument is subject to the negative procedure, and I refer members to paper 3 and pages 21 to 24 in our papers pack. Does any members wish to raise any issues with instrument? Mercedes.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I was wondering if it's possible to write to the Minister to ask the Scottish Government to update us on how the scheme is running and what the sector is telling the Scottish Government about how effective the scheme has been in supporting the industry.
Thank you. We can certainly do that. We can write any queries to the Scottish Government. Rachel Hamilton.
Could I also ask if the issues with the Chinese licence being withdrawn and the COVID outbreak at the pig abattoir at Brechin had an impact and was part of the decision making for the Scottish Government to go forward with this intervention?
Okay. Any further comments? I'd certainly like to raise how the SSI, with regards to the private storage aid scheme, links in with the previous hardship scheme, which I think ran for 3 weeks, and whether the government will get any plans to reintroduce the hardship scheme in the back of this. I would also like to raise the issue of potential fraud, where funding is provided to store this the carcasses, but what checks are in place to ensure that those carcasses aren't released early, processed and back into the food chain using butchering facilities out with Scotland, if that is the case, and also how much total funding is available through the scheme. Rachel.
On the point of funding, which budget is that funding coming from? I'd like to know. And from the producer's point of view, which is obviously incredibly important for animal welfare, what is the capacity of that scheme?
Okay, Jim.
Yeah, I would just like to ask, I was going to ask what the capacity is in order to see what volume is going to be stored, and also will there be a market trigger as to when this can be re-released back into the food chain?
Thank you. Any further questions? Okay, are members content to note this instrument? Okay, and with your agreement, I will write to the Cabinet Secretary with the questions that have been raised with regards to this instrument. And that concludes our public business for today, and I now move into private session. Thank you.